I'd like to welcome everyone to the October 22nd meeting of the Planning Board. We typically start our meetings with an offer for public comment on anything that's not on the agenda for the night. Is there anyone who wants to do that? Seeing no, okay. Carolyn, we have the 7:30 continuation of the hearing, so right. 7 to 7:30, do you have plans for us?
We have a couple of things, but probably not going to take a half hour.
Could we also discuss the A&R early?
We have two A&Rs. Yeah, that's just other business, so we can do all that.
Okay.
I'm sorry. So I'll go ahead and do the A&Rs if you want. One of them is actually at the State Hospital. It came in the other day, so that's why it's not on the agenda. But this is Route 66 here in Village Hill Road. The male attendance building, which is one of the historic buildings that's still up there at the front end.
Can't really see it here.
Here, sorry.
No.
This long building with the big columns in the front. Mm-hmm. Is there have been several iterations of people looking at that for prospective development. But at this time, Mass Development wants to create a separate lot for that building as part of the marketing and probably finalization of whatever negotiations they have with someone. So this is really just to create a parcel that has frontage along Village Hill Road. We don't have a minimum frontage in the city, but they can't do anything on the property until a site plan is approved by the Planning Board. So this is just to create the lot.
Is there any discussion about what they get out of the adjacent lots from doing that? I mean, what's the
Well, the Haskell building is right here.
Is for that.
Well, they recently, you know, I'm not really sure why it's drawn this way, because there was recently a negotiation to get more land from the state on this side, but that's not included in this. I'm not really sure. But when they come to you all for site plan, you'll get an idea of what's being proposed.
Why haven't you gone through this for the few other buildings that have been saved, like the coach house or the apartment buildings?
Well, because sometimes it happens before, sometimes it happens after. Actually, it usually only happens after permitting. I don't know why they submitted it now. I'm not sure if, so what happened with the coach house was it didn't get, the project fell through, so it never got to that point where they actually had to create the lot, although they may have created it as part of parceling out the other abutting parcels as the development happened there, so I think that's
already. But in each case, this process has occurred, that right. A lot's been created for an existing building.
Yeah.
So
the only thing that there again, the A&R is you're signing off that this doesn't require subdivision approval because it's along a public street. Village Hill has already been accepted as a public street.
So our point of consideration is are we comfortable with Carolyn taking action on the A&R for this?
Again, approval not required. You can only determine that it's not a subdivision so long as it meets the frontage requirements along a street and not dependent upon any other questions
that.
You have.
Right.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
So can I have a move, therefore?
So moved.
Second. Moved by John, second by Tess, that we have Carolyn take care of the A&R for is it the attendance building?
Male attendance building.
All in favor? So for those who are joining us, we're taking care of some business because we put the agenda item on for 7:30, so we can't open that room until 7:30.
Well, because it's a long hearing, way back in August or whenever it was last continued, we had no idea what might be coming forward in the pipeline, if there might be a smaller project. And if you had put it at the top of the agenda, then the smaller project would have been way back behind. So, you know, it's a tough call. There's another A&R. This one's on West Hampton Road. And it's really for transferring a sliver of property. This is sort of at the top of the hill. Do you remember where the Ridge subdivision is? This is about three parcels to the east of where the Ridge Street is, and it's on the same side as Ridgeview Road. So that would be the south side of West Hampton Road. And there's this parcel here that is a little shy of complying with the 80,000 square foot minimum lot size. So they're trying to purchase a sliver from their abutter to add to their lot so they have a fully compliant lot. And this other parcel from which this little sliver would be taken is... doesn't say what the acres it are, but it's acres and acres of land.
Okay. And so the orientation, that should be upside down for us to think about where that lot is.
I did it because I thought it would help, but I could turn it the other way. So, let me just see. I had an email that I just wanted to relay the information. So I don't know if you all are aware, this is just sort of heads up, and we can do a little brainstorming now if you feel up to it or if you want to have more time to think about it, that's fine too. But we finally received funding for money to do a complete streets plan for the city and pedestrian and transportation sort of analysis of the city. So it would be more comprehensive look citywide of how we can, you know, start making the move forward and making those infrastructure changes to meet the policy guidance, which we're actually is moving forward as a recommended ordinance for complete streets, which you saw a couple months ago, the proposed language for the ordinance for complete streets. So it would include bicycle and pedestrian facilities and safety. And so I just wanted to make you aware of that, but also that if, you all had any initial thoughts about sort of how we might go about that, what you think is a burning issue that needs to be included as part of that plan. You know, I just throw it out there on the table. This is just the very beginning because we just sort of are putting together that funding package and trying to figure out where to go with it.
How much is it?
A lot. I think it's over 100,000. But I can't remember the final numbers because we have a couple different pools that we're trying to
plan. Money.
Yeah, yeah, just planning.
This is to do what again? A street plan?
It's a complete streets plan, which means that the plan would focus on how to plan for and create and modify the existing street network so it accommodates all users in the network. So not just for vehicles, but and of course, we're not building a lot of new streets, so it's a lot about retrofitting and identifying priorities for how we accomplish a street network that is really a place for all modes of traffic, all users, everyone from, you know, childhood to 100 years old. And that many, that typically includes retrofitting intersections with physical design changes to the intersections with curb bump outs and crosswalks and traffic calming or complete modification of a street so it slows traffic down. So it's a plan focused on those kinds of issues.
So it's a master plan for the streets, street access. So what input do you need from us at this stage as far as what to focus on? Or
nothing particular. I don't know if, I mean, if there was something, if there were any issues that you felt like you wanted to make sure that we were, you know, covering. This is, again, we haven't even, you know, started out the scoping.
Does that covers the entire city, or are we focusing on?
No, it would be the entire city. And sort of looking at which kind of streets.
It's like a big stretch, but.
Yeah, it's not to say that we wouldn't treat different streets differently depending on where they are in the city, you know, and how much population they're serving or what type of population is serving. But it's really to look at the whole network. And so, no, I'm not.
So you're giving us heads up to tell us that you are going to be developing said plan, mm-hmm. and it will eventually come to us for consideration once it's developed.
Will you all be part of the development of the plan? We haven't, you know, embarked on it at all. So
I mean, wouldn't it make more sense to identify, you know, problem areas in the city and focus the money on those?
That's sort of the step after having a plan, you know, how do we address the problem areas depending on what kind of problem it is and creating priorities for that. So and then create sort of a strategic approach once, because we know a lot about where the problem areas are, but we don't have a consistent plan or focus on how we're going to address those. So that's why we typically fall back on a plan when we're trying to spend money in places and we don't have that detailed of a plan.
And are you getting state HCIP money or are you getting federal highway money?
We're getting bits and pieces of different grant money and also traffic mitigation money is going into it.
Okay.
And other state funds. I think we're going to throw some money from the the housing, the 40R housing development program that the state has. So once you build affordable housing, then the state essentially reimburses the city.
Okay.
Is there some kind of material, 2 pages, 3 pages, outline, something else about this that you could share?
We can, not at this point, but
no,
we can,
but
certainly.
I don't mean that. I mean the complete streets program material.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a pretty rich website at the Federal Highway Administration.
Okay.
That they've just got, you know, the section of their web pages allocated to it.
Okay.
And I just saw a guidance memo from them, and that's why I wondered whether you're getting state money or not.
Yeah.
Outlining what are the requirements, but not precluding your, what's the design book that you use, the Greenwood?
Oh,
NATO.
Yeah.
NATO. And there are other guidance books like that that Carolyn would have.
And that's actually on our web. We have a link to that from the planning page.
Question, this goes into the implementation phase after the study's done, but on the capital improvement committee, every year the DPW comes in front of us with hundreds of millions of dollars of backlog issues, amongst which are several streets that are targeted or they need traffic calming. The residents have put in repeated requests for traffic calming. But dollar-wise, percentage against the whole, they're so far down the list that some we've seen, you know, private citizens come forth to pool their money to just have something done on their street. Mm-hmm. So with those, the implementation of this, with the action on those streets, would it be affected or in any different way because of the study? We have that study to fall back on, or would it change the way streets are dealt with?
Yeah, I mean, there are a couple things that are moving forward. I think it would. It would sort of set the framework and probably better organize all of those requests and put, and then when the city could establish sort of a protocol for how we're going to address these, what, you know, what are the priority streets to address so that, you know, they'll be done systematically as opposed to randomly with people making requests to parking and transportation, whatever it is. And also, so in a parallel track, we have this other policy as part of the update of the comprehensive plan, the Sustainable Northampton plan. We're looking, as you know, about taking those policies and making them into more, into codified, you know, regulations so that it's not just a policy that the city's going to implement complete streets designs when they go and fix streets, but it's going to be more required and guidance about how you go and repair the street and not just, well, if you are, that the better thing to do is to fix the street in this way. It's, no, we're fixing the street in this mm-hmm. mechanism. So there are sort of two things going in parallel, but we want the overarching plan to be in place so that that's a solid framework and a guidance.
Will this plan be developed and coordinated with the DPW for, for instance, so they have streets that need to get repaved, they have streets that need all the utility work done before they can get repaved, mm-hmm. and then they have traffic calming on streets, some of which are slated to be, you know, paved,
right.
and utility, so it all kind of comes together. It's not just from the street up.
Right.
A lot of it's from the street down
right.
first.
Well, especially about the backlog, you know, we
right.
want to go put a Band-Aid on top when...
Exactly, right. So, and with the paving that was done this past summer, it was received very well from, you know, you take a street like Woodlawn and everybody was so thankful that something like that was done. But then you look at the backlog that has yet to be done and it's just, it's, you know, it's depressing. But,
And those were just surface repairs too, wasn't
right.
it?
Right, right.
I mean, in some case there were improvements too.
Like on North Street a couple of years ago, they ripped up everything
right.
because
right.
they had to do, and so, and in that area, when they did it, they, I don't think it was the plan at the beginning, but at the end, they had sidewalks on both sides, and they had curbing, and they had signage, and they did it the right way as well as they could. And had there been a plan, I would imagine that would have been part of the plan. But as long as it's coordinated so it's not done in a vacuum, and it conflicts with what DPW is trying to do or how they're prioritizing things.
Right. So take North Street as an example. When DPW went out to look at the design for the reconstruction of that, it really fell back on policy and departments remembering what would be important to throw in the mix for the reconstruction. And so instead of having that fall on people who remember or policies, you know, we want to have some plan, you know, some
right.
concrete framework so that DPW isn't, you know, designing it in a vacuum.
Right.
And certainly I think, you know, we know what kinds of larger scale developments are coming up, particularly on Pleasant Street. So as long as we're being very smart about thinking about improvements and being strategic, not for what's there, but we know that demographically and, you know, things
right.
are going to change pretty dramatically over the next couple of years. So
yeah.
I would love for us to make sure that we're kind of thinking on another order of magnitude of pedestrians or cyclists or, you know, than what we have.
So Mark, I was thinking like on North Street, an example is at every intersection you would have a little more of a bump out if we had had a
right.
complete street spot.
Right.
So.
Right.
Whereas they did do some things,
right.
but they didn't really have the whole character list to follow.
Yep. Yep. Okay.
So that will be coming in the next several months. We'll be working on that and bringing you, you know, in and probably creating some kind of, you know, committee or working group to work on.
Okay.
That's all I got.
Caught up on our minutes?
No, I mean, I didn't send them out to you, so. So that'll have to be next time, so.
Well, according
you might
to my
to
clock,
it.
It's 7:30. So,
I'd like to open a hearing.
Oh, is it really 7:30?
No.
I can't possibly sit here and just stare at people.
Yeah, well,
I will. Since we have a room full, though, I'd like to remind you to turn your phones on vibrate or turn them off.
I need to set up the computer anyway. So.
Yeah, will you set up the computer?
You guys can take a coffee break.
I do have something that is related to what we're going to do, but I think when the air comes up that we should generate a conversation about it. It has to do with your clarification of what to us is the difference between subdivision, site plan.
Oh, yeah, we should.
Okay.
I guess we gotta sit there. I guess we just have to sit there.
I tried to handle it in my usual non-.
I would have been right with you.
Okay, so I'm gonna go sit on the computer anyway.
The projector looks suspiciously like it's been tinkered with. Is it working?
The last I checked, it was. I couldn't get any help, so I just.
It wasn't for CPC last night.
I know, that's what I heard, that's why I came down.
It was not working?
No, it doesn't work half the time.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sent out.
I don't know what the. Neither one of them hit second.
Yeah.
Neither one of them had anything on it. That's the second question.
Right.
So.
I have not asked her, sorry.
Yeah.
It's simply.
Largest project. Certainly going forward, but it's the last large parcel with it.
Oh.
So basically, it's.
So maybe they.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
And then what, is there another phase that's over here or something?
You get points for notes.
Well, this is.
So like, what's this parking lot?
Need some points.
You do.
Multi-colored.
You know, I think you were. I think you were pulling wild cards.
Well, they're not, they're all town, so they're all.
Bird, and here we all are.
My understanding is not, they're not gonna be rent, you know, they're not gonna be investment properties, they're, you know, they're owner occupied.
Right.
Who else is the.
But it's shared parking, so this person is gonna park still.
Yes.
So they're all gonna park there.
Yeah, are you an associate?
So you like this part over here?
I don't like that part, that's not dense enough for me, Bill, come on, you know where I live.
What do you want, like one big building?
Yes, one giant building, where nobody has to shovel snow.
Although, since we have our even number, we're majority of six.
I think it's where you can walk to Haymarket.
Is that.
Right. Like, there's a mix over here.
Yeah.
But then the further you get out, you know, like here, if you, somebody blindfolded and you just dropped you over here, you'd think you're just in a, you know, suburb.
I was gonna say, that ain't gonna work.
Somebody upstairs.
And there's.
Just that's what, you know, that's what people want, but I think originally they're probably bought in, thinking that it was gonna end up being something else.
Right.
And that's the challenge, so, you know.
I mean, because they were gonna reuse some of those.
Right, a lot of the existing historic buildings have been demolished.
So they decided it probably just wasn't feasible to.
Right, so originally they're gonna save six or seven, and they ended up saving three or four.
Right.
And are any of those buildings used for educational purposes?
Yeah, two apartments, the male.
And what I think is.
I've seen five different developments go through that, everything from a hotel, the condos, to. And I think somebody's working on it now, but nobody's ever been able to make something work.
Which one?
In order.
The male attendance building, which is down here, is that, it's a long, it's just a, it's a tough building, it's a long, skinny building.
Brian says hi.
You know, he told me.
And it's concrete, and it's just hard to do anything with.
Boutique hotel.
Yeah, exactly. So, I don't know, see.
It's hard, I mean, it is, it's very close to town, it's close enough to.
I mean, have that opportunity to develop very much.
Site, it's just, it's such a shame, I mean, I realize we need to see the tax base in the city.
That's the thing, it's either lose the company or.
Right.
A lot of business up there, businesses, we didn't want.
There's supposed to be so much more commercial space than.
Right.
I mean, that kind of, yeah, makes up the vast majority of the commercial square foot.
Yes, absolutely.
Right, that's exactly right.
It's like a big gray battleship.
Yeah, yeah.
If only we could have food trucks.
What's that?
If only we could have food trucks.
Yeah, exactly.
Raking it in.
Is this the biggest crowd ever in Charlotte?
Yeah, Lumberyard.
Yeah, Lumberyard is pretty big.
Yeah.
One of, it's big.
SRO.
Would you take a nap before the meeting? Could be in for a long.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So who's the other? Devin, Dan is the other associate? Who's the other associate member?
So we will need a four vote to carry.
So really,
So if I have to recuse myself, we could be in trouble.
It actually won't, no, because then we'd have.
I mean, it's good to go.
We'd need three.
I mean, there's
that's our deal.
Three out of the four?
There's a lot of, I think there's a lot of.
There's
they've left.
One, two, three.
They've asked for a lot of waivers.
All right, four or five.
That's still four.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
That's still four, but there are other things that shouldn't be waived. And then there's things that DPW said, yes.
Five is still four.
Mm-hmm.
We have five.
But that I would think that our group probably would. So, you know, because there are things that typically not for anybody else or for any other subdivision. So it probably makes sense not to waive them in certain cases. But, yeah, so, I mean, a lot of it is the access stuff. And, you know, it does get down to very, where's the?
You know, I think
DPW report.
Like, I'm surprised about the bus shelter waiver.
Which one?
Bus shelter waiver. I'm surprised about
yeah.
that. I mean, I know we're on, sorry. Do you Strava?
What's that?
Do you Strava?
Do I Strava?
Right.
Yeah. Probably
apparently
not.
Apparently not. Yeah, yeah.
I've Strava a little bit.
What is Strava?
But not I don't like to run with my device.
It's GPS tracking for various activities, and it's so it's almost like Facebook for running, cycling.
Well, I'm sure my son
does
for running. They go off all over the place.
So people,
there's several apps for that.
They have segments.
Gotcha. We're counting.
Let's say they go for a run, and you're the fastest person in a particular stretch.
Counting on you.
To be the king of the world. Oh,
wow.
You'd have like
the first
record.
Yeah.
But it's neat because of the
screenshots
that it produces. There's a lot of ancillary data about people's activity.
Right.
Like for complete streets. Like if
I'll be just looking at yours,
Benny. For a week.
Right.
It would be really neat to see, you know, who's walking, who's in a car, who's, you know, who's doing what where.
Interesting.
You comment, and yeah, it's fascinating.
Oh, yeah, I just saw those this afternoon. I didn't get a chance to read.
Yeah, from start looking as a group instead of, or you can always just take people's Kings of the Mountain. I don't do that. There's a whole group of people who do it. But it would be cool.
Stop.
Yeah, my son.
Okay, now I think it's Carol. Nick.
Yes. Now we have to get, we have to download the presentation.
You are just anxious, Devin.
There, you can start.
Do you have one?
Load up on coffee before the meeting?
Or what's on, right? Devin.
She must have money on the game.
Next, where's 10:30 or 11?
A couple weeks. Decaf.
Got money on the game.
Yeah, exactly.
Potentially.
Actually, I've got to go home back after this.
Potentially.
Oh, where are you headed?
Potentially.
Kentucky.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, here you go.
I mean, the presentation.
Right. Okay. Your son on the team?
Do you want?
Huh?
He's a runner?
Yeah, high school. And this, running into the sawmill hills or whatever, and then they come back and they all huddle around the computer and figure, well, Carolyn, and figure out where they were and how many miles. So, so if I have to recuse myself, there's nothing with the numbers, right? They're still good.
Because Dan and I are associates.
You're not an associate.
I'm not.
We have two.
Yeah, Dan and Al.
Yeah, we have enough.
Well,
we're still good.
Yeah.
Great. Wow.
Huh? Appreciate your input on this.
Okay, I've been given the go ahead here now.
I'm sorry, I just realized that.
And I'm ready to open the hearing on the Energy Positive Home scheduled for 7:30. Since some of you may not have been to these meetings before, I'll sort of give you a heads up of how we're going to proceed through the process. We start with an applicant giving us a presentation so that, and you all see it too, so that we've all sort of get that as a starting point. Then we as a board will ask them questions, and then we'll open it up to public comment for you, and you will be invited to come up to the lectern, state your name and address. If you have a comment, we're here to hear you. If your comment has already been made, please don't
feel bad about saying, and I just summarize your comment as appropriate to someone else's comment. And then we'll close the public hearing part of it, and when we do that, we've brought the activity back to the board, so it won't be involved with you at that point. And we will have our board discussion, and then we will vote on the process. There are actually two things before us to vote on tonight. The board could consider them together, but I will also ask their opinion on whether they want to consider them separately. One is a definitive subdivision part, and the second is a major site plan part. So the subdivision part is the structure and nature of the infrastructure that supports the houses that are going in, and the site plan part are the houses and the layout and what is actually being built there. So I have an announcement from Mark Sullivan.
Yep, just for full disclosure, because of what I do professionally, the applicant's presenter, Jeff from Berkshire Design, we have worked in the past, my company, and I'm currently working with Berkshire Design. I don't feel it affects me from being objective, but if anybody in the public feels differently, if you raise your hand, I'll just recuse myself from this particular hearing.
Awesome way. Evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jeff Squire from the Berkshire Design Group. I'm here on behalf of Transformations and Energy Positive Homes. We're proposing the final subdivision portion of the North Campus at Village Hill. What I'll try to do, I've got a lot of slides. There's a lot of information to go through. I'll try to keep this as brief as I can while providing you the information that you need. Please feel free to interrupt me along the way if you have questions, but hopefully I hit on all the major topics as we go through. So the site that we're looking at is this northern part of the North Campus. The last piece of land that's slated for residential development, at least as far as I know, at Village Hill, sort of fulfills the vision of redeveloping the Old State Hospital into a planned community, essentially. It encompasses roughly 42 acres. It goes from roughly just north of the existing detention basin on the east side, all the way up to the Mill River, bounded by the property, the Hospital Hill property on the west side. There is one remaining parcel here that's left for development. I know there's various discussions about what may or may not happen there, but this fulfills the remainder of the land at Village Hill. One thing I will note is that this project, even though the land itself encompasses roughly 42 acres.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but can you invite questions? Yeah. I already am confused. You said this is the final
residential phase of
development, but yet there's that whole other parcel that you said is still cited for development.
That I think may be a school, it could be a long-term care facility.
Or residential?
I don't know. I don't think it's supposed to be more residential, but I can't say that for sure. But this is the last major. I don't know if that.
Okay. Alan, we did have a preliminary subdivision submitted proposing, I think it's 22 units or something like that, just so you know.
So
for that last piece.
Okay.
Well, for the last piece on the northern campus, on this north of Ford Crossing.
All right, so that is likely, or if approved, it also would become residential.
Right.
Okay, so I apologize for misspeaking, but this is the last major piece. As I was saying, it doesn't. While the acreage encompasses roughly 42 acres, the proposed project, the work itself doesn't. It's only on a fraction of that. Really, where the development is concentrated is really up in this portion here. This is an overlay on a ortho photograph, so hopefully you can get a better idea. Mill River is up on the northeast corner. Some of the existing trail system is visible in the back, in the background. The end of the Ford Crossing piece is here. There's two intersections that were left after the construction of Ford Crossing for this future development. So right now, really up in here, this area here is all open field. There's some large piles of material, earth, excavation that's been stockpiled there. It's currently vegetated, but it all is
the former home of Old Main and the mail attendance dorm, which used to be up here. The lower portion of the site, there's a large wooded section. The lower portion of the site is largely now inhabited by a lot of trees that have grown in since the hospital sort of transferred over to this project and this development in general. So there's a lot of new trees. A lot of this used to be open meadow in here. There was a recreation building. There were a couple of other ancillary buildings to the state hospital on the east portion of the site. Right now, this here is the overflow drainage swell from the larger detention basin on the east side, overflows to another basin here, and then finally to the Mill River. But the project, in essence, is really just in this portion here. So there's a lot of the land that remains, you know, undeveloped, shall I say.
And do you know what the proportion is, or?
I don't. I should know that number, but I don't. Yeah, I apologize. I'm going to guess it's probably about half or a little less than half, if I had to throw a dart. One of the other things I'll highlight, and I'll highlight these later too, but the darker trees here are the specimen trees that were listed in the tree inventory when Village Hill was conceived of. So those are highlighted throughout the presentation just because they are trees that we've really attempted to save and preserve throughout this whole project. I'm sorry. So the proposed project that we are looking at tonight consists of single family homes, duplexes, and a co-housing portion on the eastern part of the site. It's a total of 61 buildings, 85 housing units. Some are duplexes, considering that. They are largely energy positive buildings, structures. We are employing low impact development methods and elements in the development, which I'll go through later. It's a total of 41 new lots is what this creates. Again, just to orient you, Ford Crossing here, the extension of Olander Drive, essentially, as it loops around and up and over. What we are looking at for the subdivision piece is really this road here. And the right-of-way that goes with it and the lots that it creates. But that's the only actual subdivision road that's part of this proposal. This road here is a private drive. It does provide access to some duplexes, but it ultimately leads to the two parking lots which service the co-housing piece. So the only part that would be eventually taken by the city would be just that loop road there, which is the extension of Olander Drive. The other thing I'll point out is one of the things that we had to work through with this project is I believe it's the first subdivision that's come through under the new regulations. So there's been a transition period between the old subdivision regulations and the new one. So we're trying to figure out a way to take the new standards and apply them and merge them with the old standards and still make a cohesive development. So that's been one of the challenges and pieces of the project that I'd just like to point out. Again, it's this roadway here is the major subdivision road. It's a 24-foot wide road. It does include some neck down sections on the east intersection and on the west side in this location to 20 feet in conformance with the new subdivision regulations, which require traffic calming methods every 350 feet. We continue those just at those intersection areas, and then again for this length of curb here, it narrows to 20 feet. We've got a concrete sidewalk that wraps around the inside of the development. The outside, we're proposing a compacted stone dust gravel sidewalk, again because we are employing some LIDs, some low impact development stormwater methods. One of the things we're asking for and the new regulations provide is to do gravel sidewalks if you're utilizing low impact development elements. The major circulation of the paved sidewalk, again, the hard sidewalk, I'll use that term, is this inner loop here. There's a direct connection down to the co-housing to access the co-housing, and it also connects to the larger trail network, which I'll go through in more detail later. Components of this, just quickly, that I'll point out. All these lower units here, these eight are all duplex units, which are serviced by a shared drive, common drive, that provides access to the garages in the back. So what's visible from the street, again, is largely the front of the house, the gable ends, which have, you know, we'll look at later. To make the appearance of...
So there's 10 instead of 8, right?
Pardon?
There's 10 duplexes instead of 8?
There's 8 here, 8 duplexes here, there's 5 more over here. Oh, I'm sorry, yes, there are 10. I'm sorry, yes, there are 10 duplexes.
And I think to add to John's question, it's 21.3 acres in the development portion.
These on the outer loop here are all single-family homes. The upper homes here are also single-family homes, each with their own private drive. Some were able to do shared drives, others were not, just because of the configuration of the lots. A lot of these lots are either narrow or, you know, relatively shallow, making it difficult to create shared drives in a lot of these instances. So, you know, we've acknowledged the 15-foot driveway width minimum at the curb, at the street line, so we've respected that in all instances. Where we could do shared drives, we did. These over here, there's a drop in grade, for instance, from the street down to the trail of roughly 12 feet. So we've provided drive under garages, you know, in a shared situation in that location, but there's others that we can't. These duplexes here all utilize shared garage parking, as well as open parking spaces to satisfy the parking requirements for those. And then the duplex, the co-housing, I'm sorry, portion, again, has the parking lot, which provides parking for their tenants. Again, major trees, the specimen trees are all highlighted here. The one tree that I will point out, and it was included in the report in the initial application, is there is one tree right here, which is a European beech. And I do have some pictures, but I don't know if on the slideshow. But it's in a real poor state of health. It's over half of it's probably died. We have an arborist report in the application that, you know, speaks to its health. We had somebody come out and assess it. It's not a very good looking tree. So for those reasons, combined with the fact that trying to protect it, we didn't think, you know, anything remotely close was going to protect it. A lot of the older European beaches up there are actually starting to reach their life expectancy, their life term now, so they're starting to die off, unfortunately. And I think this is one of them. So that is the only tree, the only specimen tree of all the ones that we have on the site that we are proposing to take out, just for those reasons. But we are protecting all the rest and have gone through quite great lengths, actually, to work around the existing vegetation that's there. As I said, it creates 41 new lots. These are all single-family homes for the most part. The inside will be separate lots. The duplexes will be contained on its own lot. The same with these 5 duplexes here. There's a lot carved out for their parking and their garages. This piece, large tract of parcel over here, is all slated for the co-housing, which will also go with this northern portion of land, which, you know, is slated to go into conservation. So it all will become part of the co-housing land, but at this line here, that all everything in the northern part of that will be permanently protected with a conservation restriction. Again, 41 lots. It's a combination of single family, duplex, and co-housing. This is a quick breakdown of where they're located, and again, the numbers. We've got 23 single-family homes. There's 15 duplexes for a total of 30 units, and 32 units in the co-housing portion. Again, for a total of 61 new buildings. There's 83 new housing units, including the subdivision that this project proposes. 85. I'm math wrong. 85. Sorry. The project in its entirety is obviously proposed to be built out in phases. The first phase of development would include the extension of Olander Drive up to this intersection. It would create frontage for these three single-family homes and these five duplexes. It would include the extension of all utilities and all the infrastructure that we need up to this intersection. Phase two would include this extension. Similarly, it would create frontage for these duplexes and these lots. Phase three would be the co-housing, and then phase four would fill out the remainder. The one thing I will mention is that the co-housing piece may, once this intersection is created, depending on where buyers are at and you know, various agreements, there's a potential that some of the co-housing may come before this portion of the subdivision, just because that's the next stuff that's available. And so this is the plan right now, but if the co-housing piece moves a little bit faster, we may end up swapping phases and building out a portion of that as part of phase two.
I know you won't have a timeline, but can you give me some sort of expectation? Are we talking
5 to 8 years, I think, for full build out. Again, just looking at specimen trees. So these were the most notable specimen trees on the campus that were included in the tree inventory report way back in the early days. The majority of these are oaks. There are one or two maples, I think, these two. This is a beech tree. This is a Norway spruce, but I believe the remainder of them are all oaks. Some of them are quite large and certainly worthy of protection. And these two also here are large beech trees that are still in decent condition.
Can you explain the use of the term specimen tree?
So when the redevelopment proposal for Hospital Hill in general was conceived of, I know one of the considerations, and Carolyn could probably speak better to it, but was concern over some of the notable mature specimen trees that were on the campus. So there was an extensive tree inventory done back in 2003, 2002.
The condition of the special permit originally that established the campus, that a tree inventory had to be identified with trees that were truly significant in terms of their species, their size. And so we have a full inventory of all the trees, some of which have come down because of disease or impact from previous construction, or they were in the path of proposed roads.
So each tree is actually numbered or named?
No, they were only the ones that were considered by an arborist to be significant trees, so not every tree. So the ones that are inventoried are the ones that the planning board at the time in 2002 said, these are the trees that we want anyone moving forward for the subsequent phases to really consider preserving and to develop and design around. The other ones, there are lots and lots of other trees that were not considered to be as of great significance. So those are the ones that were called out to be particularly careful with.
I noticed from the plans there were many other trees that appeared to have the same or larger canopies that weren't designated specimen trees. Presumably there was some reason for that?
Right, it was based on the arborist's assessment of the type of the tree, the age, the quality, the benefit, and also the historical, because of its age, sort of the fact that it had been there historically during the heyday of the hospital.
I think in the report there were 300 some odd trees that were numbered and cataloged. And as Carolyn said, they were all rated on from health to size to species, all those things. And there were a list of 30 some odd trees that I think across the board had a one as being most significant and most important. So those were always deemed the quote unquote specimen trees that we really need to work to protect.
Thank you.
Sure. So those are the existing trees. There are other trees you can see, again, in the background that he was referring to that are significant. The only, the majority of those, we are proposing to keep. As I said, there's a fair number in this lower portion where the co-housing is that have, you know, evolved over time since the original hospital. You know, if you look at the campus, a lot of this used to be broken parking lot and other parts of, like, ancillary buildings and roads that serviced those, so it an open meadow. So it wasn't entirely a forested, you know, part of the campus originally, but a lot of trees have grown up there. The proposed tree, just a quick snapshot of, this isn't all the vegetation, but it does indicate what we're proposing for street trees and some of the larger sort of massing of vegetation. The street trees, because all of these homes, including duplexes and co-housing, is anticipated to have solar on the roof. We are, our tree species is consistent with the subdivision regulations that allow for shorter species trees for protection of solar access. So we do have some locations here. Here's another one, and then along the northern portion of the inside loop, there's one here that, based on the shade studies that we did, can tolerate a larger tree species. So in those locations, we did propose those. But, you know, the majority of the streetscape, because these houses are so close to the road in relationship to the street trees, you know, anything larger than the ridge line or the roof line would, you know, effectively shade the homes. And this is just an example. I've got just two quick snapshots. This is just a random day, June 19th, 9 a.m. This is an instance with the largest street trees. You can just see the shadows cast. This is, you know, the current proposal and the effect that it has. Similarly, at 4 p.m. at the end of the day, you run into, you know, a lot of shading issues on the east side of the street or the trees because of these smaller street tree varieties. We don't run into those shade issues. So that is part of the proposal, and those are effectively the reasons why. I'll just quickly run through the utilities. They're pretty straightforward. Again, we're extending the existing utility stubs that were left. It provides for an 8-inch cast iron or ductile iron water loop around the inside of Olander Drive. It'll connect back up at this intersection at the other stub. We've got services to each building. We've talked with DPW. And this is consistent with, you know, the other developments that have happened down there. Similarly to the co-housing, because there is a lot going on in a fairly dense area, it's been, you know, a challenge to try to keep those utilities separate and, you know, at the same time organized. So this, you know, this system provides for, you know, effectively a main inner line with services coming off that, so everybody knows where valves are and then those various pieces. Sanitary, similarly, we're extending the existing sanitary that was constructed. We do reach a portion in the back of the site and in this lower portion that have, each of the units has got to have an individual ejector pump because of the elevation. They're going to be, you know, maintained and taken care of by the individual homeowners, but there's really no other way to get the sanitary out from this end of the site. Oddly enough, what ended up happening is because this is really sort of the high point of the existing site now, this sanitary line can only be taken so far before the road drops in elevation to this point, then comes back up again, and comes down, and then back up. So here, you know, what starts to happen is the sanitary line starts to go underground, so we can only take it this far, but we're able to take this line under this low point and all the way around to roughly here. So it's only 1, 2, 3, I think it's only 5 units total that require an ejector pump in the upper portion of the development. We have I've talked with the DPW and have gotten the force mains on the right side of the right of way and have made sure that all those connections are according to their regulations. And then the lower portion down here will have to be individual ejector pumps or feet of force main that, again, will take it to the gravity system in the street. Grading and drainage, again, just to highlight real quickly, the high point roughly right now is at this intersection. So we've taken that high point, we gently drop to a low point here. It comes back up to a high point at the back of the site, gently comes back down to this intersection, then comes back up to meet the existing road. We drop down at 8%, which is the maximum slope we can have at that drive, down to the parking lot there. What we've really tried to do, and have put a lot of effort into, is twofold. One is to be cooler and smart about stormwater management. And the other is to try and balance the site when the project is done in its entirety to avoid having to bring in an exorbitant amount or remove an exorbitant amount of fill. I think, you know, we're only a couple thousand yards off with this project, you know, in its entirety, which, you know, is a pretty substantial, you know, number to achieve given the acreage and the volume of earth to be moved around for, you know, for all this development. And so I'll come back to this a little bit again later, but one of the things that we're looking to do in this subdivision road is get away from the standard catch basin of 200 feet tied to a closed drainage system. Here we proposed grass rails in the street and the tree belt between the curb and the sidewalk. We've got curb inlets located at various locations, which you know, I'll talk a little bit more later, to allow the water, the flush curb locations, allow the water to get off of the roadway into the drainage swale, make its way down. They're all grass swales. They do have drains at the very end of each individual swale section. So, you know, between each driveway, curb cut, or road intersection is a separate swale. Each of those is got its own yard drain, areaway drain, so it doesn't get back out into the street. They will drain completely. We do have some standard catch basins in the road at the low points in the event that, you know, there's catastrophic failure of everything else. There is still a way for the water to get out. And this was worked out with the DPW. So what we've done is we've taken, you know, it's a conventionally crowned road. Half of the road will go to the swale on the right side, half will go to the left side. There's also a low point in between these homes. So effectively there's a ridge, you know, a small grading ridge in the middle of these two portions of the street or homes. So we're taking the water, including the roof drainage, and putting them into a large rain garden in between all the homes. The notion is that it would be planted, help provide some privacy, some separation between the units, but also serve a critical stormwater function. And again, it's all tied to the larger system where it starts here at the high point, continues down, and we finally discharge at the existing detention basin, which we're able to do and utilize a little bit of leftover capacity that is in there because we are providing these grass swales and reducing the time of concentration all the way to the detention basin. The lower portion of the site, the co-housing, because we're effectively capturing all the water from this hillside here eastward, we don't want all that stormwater, all that runoff to come across the parking lot and into the site. So we are employing a regular curb, you know, conventional curb along the east side of these parking lots and this section of the road. We don't have the space for any other real effective LID or stormwater elements down there, so we are proposing 1, 2, 3 catch basins in these parking lots and a stormwater treatment chamber, which again, these swales alone don't give us the stormwater quality that we need to achieve. So the treatment chamber at the end of the line effectively will, you know, achieve the required TSS removal and everything that we need to do to comply with the city stormwater standards as well as the state stormwater standards. And I'll talk about some of the grass swales and some of those items in just another slide or two, but this is a basic cross section of the roadway and what we're proposing. So we do have a conventional granite curb on either side. Again, the road varies from 24 feet wide to 20 feet wide at the intersections or at those neck downs. There are several locations where this curb drops from a 6-inch reveal down to a flush situation to allow the storm water and the gutter to get off the street and into the swale. There's swales on either side. And as I noted, at the down gradient end of each of those individual swales, there is a yard drain, which, you know, will take any, remove any possibility of standing water. And what we've done is we've created these, look at that, but what we've done is created these wet, wet bottom swales is how they're, what they're classified as according to the stormwater, the Mass Stormwater Handbook. Again, it's all these locations sort of highlighted in green. These are just a couple of examples that I just found on the web that are somewhat representative of what we're trying to do. So it's a series of, you know, this is a detail, prescribed detail in one of the stormwater handbooks, but what they show is a, you know, linear trench that flows in a certain direction. It's divided up by permeable weirs at certain elevations to detain stormwater for, that's why they're called wet bottom as opposed to a dry bottom. Without the weirs, water would simply come off the street and go right down to the basin at the end. The goal of the weirs, the stone weirs, is to improve storm quality. The weirs that we're constructing, I think, are 6 inches, 8 inches high, so they're not anywhere near as tall as this. But when you're moving water down gradient, as you hit these weirs, small ponds of water will be allowed to stand for, you know, temporary periods as these weirs move downstream, if you understand that concept. At the end of each swale, again, is an area drain. So, you know, you detain the water temporarily. That's really the goal of the low impact development, trying to decentralize the stormwater systems, trying to return it more to natural flow patterns. And so that's really what we're trying to do. There's a lot of constraints, a lot of issues that we have to work through to be able to do what we're doing. Biggest one being the soil types, infiltration rates, groundwater, all of those things come into play. The fact that a good portion of this upper portion of the site was built over the old main infrastructure and building, which was all backfilled with structural fill. There's different, infiltration and treatment ratios there versus, you know, this just outside the old foundation wall, which might have been virgin soil. So there were a lot of things going on. This element was the one thing that we could try to do that would satisfy and conform with the stormwater handbook, with DPW standards, and still provide as much treatment, as much low impact development thrown into the project that we could. This is just a photo I took this morning from North Street, which is just again an example of how that might play out and what the idea is, where its stormwater comes off the gutter as it's moving down gradient, gets into this swale. Our swales that we're proposing are largely to be grassed, so maintenance should be a lot easier versus those that have a lot of vegetation. We are showing a little bit in this detail just around those area drains at the end. Again, I think one of the goals of this project is really to advertise and highlight some of the sustainable development methods, techniques. I think part of the thought was that a grass swale leading to an area drain with nothing else was a little bit half-hearted, that, you know, at least have some vegetation, some wetland plants around the area drain to hide that, to disguise that, to speak to the fact that you're trying to create some sort of rain garden feature and stormwater feature that's a little bit more visible. One of the other benefits of this system that we're proposing is that in the current master plan, this dashed outline here is approximately one of the watershed areas that was proposed in the original calculations for the site, which all drain to this detention basin on that western slope. From the start of this project, one of the real goals was to not have to build that detention basin for, you know, all the reasons that, you know, I think anybody else wouldn't want to build a large detention basin on a pretty well-forested, steep, you know, slope. It was really gonna, you know, have an impact. So one of our goals was trying to get rid of that. So we actually picked up a lot of this area with our proposal, shifted the water to the east rather than to the west. And we were able to do that because, you know, again, we're slowing down reducing the time of concentration from, you know, the source to its ultimate discharge point. So we're able to take advantage of, you know, not only the storage capacity in that existing basin, but also avoid the need to construct that, you know, the large detention basin on the west side of the site. These are just some of the details from the project plans that highlight what we're trying to do in these swales. Again, it's granite curb in you know, the majority of the development. We have these locations where you know, the granite curb will slope down to a flush section that's 2 feet wide. Also a granite curb slope back up. Those are in several locations throughout the subdivision road. And we've strategically located those stone check dams so that water coming off of the street through those flush curb locations are confronted with a check dam before it gets to the area drain in almost all instances. So we're trying to get as much treatment, stormwater treatment, as we can by, you know, temporarily holding water for you know, for a short period of time and letting some of the sediment fall out. I'll do a quick run through of the two sites specifically and some of the architecture and the units that are being proposed. This first part is the single family homes and the duplex portion. Again, the single family homes are all these houses highlighted in orange. It's a variety of house styles in character with the design standards of the remainder of the rest of Village Hill. We are, again, as we have in all the other portions of development up here, faced with challenges of trying to create public space, private space, maximize the density, because that's, you know, a lot of what this was about, and still trying to achieve you know, a very comfortable, desirable place to live. So again, different unit types, configurations, floor plans, all those have been, you know, adjusted so that we can try to create some you know, some open space, some private space around each of the back of these units. Again, the idea in the center here is that this will largely be a, you know, stormwater function. We'll take a lot of the runoff from the homes and you know, the what doesn't sink into the ground into a, you know, a depression, a rain garden, effectively. These are just some of the architectural elevations of single-family homes. These are two different single-family homes. In the upper portion, this is the one I was speaking to before about the drive-under garage on the east side of the site. Porches, a lot of the elements that you've seen common in some of the other developments. You know, I think one of the things that should be acknowledged is that, like any of the other homes up there, that you know, we've got footprint shown for the entire development, but because of the build out and the phasing of this, there's a very good likelihood a lot of these are going to change. So as we've done with you in the past, as, you know, houses come online or get under contract, that we'd, you know, come before you, present to the planning office what the actual proposal is, how that differs, if any, from, you know, what's shown here, and then you know, make a determination whether we need to come back to you for an amendment or how, you know, how to deal with that site plan approval process. But it's not dissimilar from anything else that we've dealt with up there so far. So you know, what we're presenting is a variety of house styles with whose footprints we've used for this project. These are a couple of houses that were recently built by Transformations as well on Laurel Street, which is also part of the hospital, overall hospital project, but it's not connected to the North Campus physically. But there's four homes along Laurel Street that were just recently built. Again, some of these are very similar in style, if not identical in style, to some of the homes that are being proposed up at up on the North Campus. Duplexes, again, it's these 10 structures here and these five duplex buildings here, and then includes the garages. These are the style for the main center of campus and the central portion of campus. Again, they have a lot of the similar elements to some of the other single-family homes. The goal is that they all fit in, share a common you know, common style, common architectural elements to make them not stand out so much as duplexes. These are really faded, I apologize. These are duplexes, a couple of different duplex styles for the other five on the eastern portion of the site. Again, very similar elements as what you've seen. There's carriage house styles, there's a Greek revival. A lot of the architectural guidelines that were established, these are very consistent with what those buildings are. Lastly, the co-housing, that's this portion of the site on the east side. There's a total of, 23 units. There's like 23 buildings, 32 units. Right. All of these are residential units. This is the common house. These are the remainder of the residential units in the northern portion, and then there's a shared workshop, you know, utility space for, just gardening materials, wheelbarrows, those types of things. This is not unlike any of the other co-housing developments. There's a very motivated group that is working hard to, finalize plans and select unit styles for this. So their input has been critical, you know, through this whole design process in terms of how they lay out. Again, these have been very strategically located. Some are single-story structures, some are two-story, recognizing the need to preserve solar access because these will all have solar. We've located them in strategic locations so that their elevations don't affect the home to the north or south. I'll quickly run through the elevations of I think there's five building styles that are proposed. This is the common house, which is in the center of the development. These are a couple of the single story building units. This is obviously a two-story unit. Some of these are duplexes, some are singles. This is a third architectural rendering of we're calling building three. Another single story, some of these are, a lot of these vary in bedrooms from one bedroom, two bedroom, up to four bedrooms, and depending on, again, the configuration on the inside. This is the last building style with some of the porches and, again, other elements that you've seen in some of the other buildings. Across Fitch Architects is working with the co-housing group and developing the architectural plans for that portion of the development. The last thing I'm going to touch on real quick is just the trail system, because that's always been an integral and important part to Village Hill and has evolved into a very significant feature up there. So one of the other challenges that we were faced with was how to place this proposed project on the site and still preserve a lot of the existing trail connections, the character of those trail systems, because a lot of them, especially in the back, are distinctly different than some of the ones in the southern portion of the campus. So this just real quickly highlights where the existing trails are now. A lot of these were former roadbeds, but right now, for all intents and purposes, I'll call them trails. This is the north end of that larger detention basin, just for reference. So up to roughly, I think, this point here, it's paved. It goes across that drainage, that existing drainage swale via, there's some cobblestone pavers there. And then it was left to be picked up on the other side. This is, again, an old roadbed that is currently used as a trail system. So real quickly, this trail comes up. One of the big challenges was this, where it crosses the drainage swale, that was really coming into the middle of the co-housing development. And it was really hard to try and figure out how to preserve that crossing, that trail in its entirety, without coming through some significant portion of that co-housing development. The grades get real steep on the west side. This area in here is really the flattest, most conducive area to develop in that portion of the site. So it became apparent that we were going to have to find a different way to connect these trails. So real quickly, this trail and back here is all maintained. It's in its original location. There's one little spot here that, if any of you have been out there, there's a steep rise in the grade there, probably 8, 10, 12 feet, real sharply up to this sort of upper terrace level. And then it drops back down onto this old roadbed. It's not ADA accessible, doesn't meet current standards. So all we've done is taken it around that mound with this little connection here. But this piece here, all of this, and this northern extension here is all the existing trail system that's there. Similarly, it comes up from, you know, the interior portion of Village Hill, of Village Hill Road, crosses over. It was intended that there needs to be a north-south trail connection from the southern part of the north campus to the north, and then similarly east-west. This is currently where the central north-south connection comes. There's also this trail over here. It comes up. We are taking it up the concrete sidewalk down that private drive, and then we're taking it through the drive that leads to the the duplex developments there. We've got a striped bicycle, you know, pedestrian shared lane there because there's minimal traffic with these. It cuts right back into the woods at the end. We're right at grade. We don't need to do any grading under this large canopy of existing trees. Not all of these are specimen, but it is a real nice grove of oaks that's very open underneath. And it connects right up to this trail intersection here. And then to get from this eastern portion of the site up to what is the existing roadbed now was also a bit of a challenge. And there were a number of constraints that we had to work through. One was, just go back to this for a minute. One was ensuring the protection of these large beech trees that are both specimen trees. The other was satisfying ADA requirements for recreational trails. We can have portions of the trail that reach 8%, but it can only be for a certain percentage of the overall trail system. So we were constrained by a maximum of an 8% grade for, you know, a certain portion of the trail. And then we also had this drainage swale that we had to figure out a way across. So one of the things that we were running into is coming up as far north as we could and then coming over. To be able to make the grades work, we were effectively coming over this drainage swale at 5 or 6 feet height, foot height, which would have required a bridge with abutments, and it was an exorbitant amount of work to get across a drainage swale at an elevation that just didn't make any sense with everything else that you were trying to do around it. It was going to be substantially higher. There were a lot of trees down in this location that we would have had to have dealt with and or removed to make the grading work, to be able to connect the grade down here with the grade up here. I'm not sure what the differential is, but it's probably, I would guess it's probably 25, 30 feet maybe. And so what we chose to do, what we're proposing to do, is pick the trail up. There's a paved portion of trail that currently exists on, so this is looking south, just to orient everybody. This is looking south. This is the large detention basin that's in this location in the plan. This is looking south, so these are the single family homes that are built along the east side of Olander. The trail right now is just on the other side of these trees. This is the large grove of beech trees that was protected during the construction of this basin. The other side of those beech trees is a paved walk that comes up and crosses probably somewhere over around here, this drainage swale that you can see. So part of this detention system here, there's an outlet pipe from the basin that outlets, that daylights approximately in this location. There's a 24-inch concrete pipe that daylights some of the runoff, some of the overflow from this basin into that drainage swale. And then the swale gets, you know, deeper to accommodate the daylighting of that outlet pipe. The grade between from the outlet pipe to the basin, there's actually natural cover. There's vegetative cover over the pipe. So we're able to cross, what we're proposing to do is bring the trail over prior to the daylighting of that pipe to avoid having to create a bridge. It avoids, the other thing it avoids is that cobble crossing now is consistently wet because it receives all the runoff from this drainage swale, so that's always going to be wet. This avoids that whole issue. It doesn't, you know, you're not forced to cross that drainage swale. So the notion is to wrap it right along this tree line, which is this same tree line here. The detention basin in this picture is on the left. This is where we propose to bring the trails up right along this wood edge and then head right for the tree edge, tree line here, which we're able to accommodate the grades. We're able to get up to the elevation that we need to with the beech trees. So this is another image looking south. This is the large, large beech tree at the very end. And you can see this leads right into you know, one of the first single family homes on that stretch, northern stretch of Olander. There's another trunk of one of the large beech trees here. The grade drops quite a bit off this old roadbed. But you can see in this picture, this is looking back up the hill, that there's actually this was all a former parking lot. If you know, kick under some of the duff that's on the forest, there's a lot of broken pavement. It used to be one of the old parking lots. So a lot of this is secondary growth. But we're actually able to accommodate the grades from, you know, this lower portion of the site up to the trail that joins up at these beech trees. We've got a portion right under the beech trees in an effort to protect them that we're proposing to construct a boardwalk. There's, I think, 100-foot span under that that goes from the edge of that tree line, basically, up to this grade here. It's approximately 100 feet. It's this distance in this image. So what we're proposing to do is once you reach that forest edge, it'll transition to a wood boardwalk, the same 8-foot wide. It allows us to span most of the existing soils. It's not a lot of elaborate engineering. It's a couple of, concrete footings. There's a span, above that, and the drop wouldn't be that great. The grade right now in this location is approximately 8% as it currently exists. So the goal is to really just ride across that existing grade for as long as we could, and we can meet the grade up at this trail bed where it'll revert back to asphalt and continue on to the north. Again, just images of what the style of boardwalk that we're proposing in the plans. And I'll just leave these were a couple of renderings that were done during the preliminary planning process, but I think I convinced Carter to let me use them in the presentation because I think they evoke what we're really trying to do with this final phase of significant phase of residential development up there. These large carports are obviously taken out, but it's really trying to push the development and sustainability standards for development in general, but we think is a fitting sort of finale to what's happened up at Village Hill so far. So I'll leave it at that.
Open it up for questions from the board, and I would say since we've got so many people tonight, we will probably ask Jeff. He'll be here, so when we actually get to our deliberations, we would still be able to ask.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So we.
Yeah, I would recommend keeping that open.
Yeah.
So that would allow us to get to the people who are visiting. But comments, questions?
Yes, sorry.
Just to understand, so on the entire 42 acres, your proposal is to use about 21.
Yes.
Approximately. But historically, before the secondary growth, was the entire 42, for lack of a better term, developed with the old hospital, grounds,
no.
Buildings? How much of that was?
It's roughly about the same.
Oh, okay.
I can go back to the existing pictures, but the trail system, particularly on the north side, was really a lot of the access roads that used to connect some of the, with the outside access loop to a lot of the existing buildings. The northern end of that upper meadow was where the male attendance dorm, which was really the last, the the furthest north building of any significance. And then there was some, like I say, ancillary buildings and development on the east side, but they were a lot smaller.
Mark. Carolyn, there were some late memorandums from the DPW. I don't know if you've seen those.
Yes, yep. I'll touch on those real quickly if you want, but yeah.
Yeah, there are implications of this. There's some issues that are addressed in the memorandum. I just don't know where we stand relative to the presentation.
Well, I think there are a lot of comments that I think the board should consider for conditions. I don't know. I think my recommendation would be, since we I didn't have time to completely evaluate all the comments from DPW. I guess just my initial recommendation to you all, and that's for you to consider, obviously, is perhaps you know, taking a little bit more time to think about how those might be incorporated into conditions. So if you close out the hearing and give yourselves time to think more about which ones make sense for conditions, sort of at a subsequent meeting. I don't know, but yes, there are some significant comments that I think should be incorporated, and I've started to identify some of those, but you know, it was a 9-page memo, some of which I think were, you know, several pages were plan fixes that need to be made because there were errors in the numbers and things of that sort, which don't necessarily need to be gone through item by item, because I think they generally can be lumped into the category of edit your plans, make them perfect before they get endorsed.
Right.
But then there are other ones that I think probably make sense to discuss. So
there are some like broad reaching statements, for instance, site plan that was submitted that's dated June 9th, which is what we have, has not been updated to reflect the revisions that were made to the subdivision plans on October 1st.
Right.
So I don't know what those differences are, or if those differences are significant, maybe they're not.
Yeah, I think I actually know for sure that they just want to make sure all the plans are consistent and reflecting the same design. So the applicant chose to focus on the subdivision because that's the real infrastructure piece. And so in terms of, so all the infrastructure elements relate to the site plan applications as well, because there's a private street that goes in to serve the co-housing plus serve the common driveway for the singles and duplexes. And the drainage system is all connected to the same drainage system that we're talking about for the subdivision street. So there's probably, you know, the things that were changed on the site plan relate to the design, the a little bit of change to some of the housing units, but you've also heard that they want to allow some flexibility, so you probably need to see those designs anyway before building permits were pulled for that individual house lot. So I wouldn't, I don't think that's a huge concern. I think just in the end, before anything is recorded, before subdivision plans are endorsed, we need all the plans to say the same thing across, you know, the three permits.
Yes.
And can you, for the board and the public, give an abridged summary of, there's a private road going to co-housing, and the requirements for the subdivision and the sidewalks and the development around the subdivision are different than the co-housing because it's a private road. Could you summarize?
It's a little bit different, but again, your standards require that when you're building infrastructure, even if it's a private system, that it still be built to comparable standards in the subdivision regulations. Initially, it was actually labeled as a private street, and so that's why I think you should treat it that way, because it needs to have a sidewalk, it needs to have drainage, it needs to have landscaping and all of that. So, and the pavement depths have to be built according to subdivision standards, and so, well, you want all the technical aspects to be there. The difference is you can have private streets and public streets. The private streets, the public still has the right to cross those because it's, you know, serving this big co-housing. So, but it's not going to be a street in which the city will be asked to take over and maintain. And in this situation, there are actually, it's a little bit confusing because there are elements of the subdivision street, which we know, because we know from the beginning of this whole project going back to 2002, the idea was the city would take over the public streets as a public as part of the public system. But there are aspects that will have to be privately maintained by the owners association. So, you know, the area drains and the they're proposing a gravel walk, which I think the board needs to discuss as well. Those would all have to be maintained. So that's a little bit different than the way that typically a public street
right.
is maintained. However, in many previous subdivisions, the board has also, and the city has also required that things like storm sectors or the specific pieces of infrastructure that do, that require a little bit of different type of maintenance be maintained by the by a private association anyway. So it's not like we're entering new territory, but there are some differences.
Just to follow up with Jeff, on the presentation, you focused, technically speaking, along the subdivision lines, on the subdivision.
Right.
Extending that technical discussion to the co-housing, is there anything different planned in a substantive manner for sidewalks, curbing, drainage, anything like that?
No. I mean, there are sidewalks, you know, that are proposed throughout the development or throughout the co-housing, but there's nothing extraordinary or anything that you wouldn't typically see with a normal, you know, service connection or utility connection to any of the homes. The only thing, as I pointed out, was the individual ejector pumps, just because of the elevation of the development down there.
So you can only extend the existing sanitary so far because those grades have always been there. Nothing's changed. So does that mean the existing sanitary where you're picking up, is at the wrong elevation? Did somebody goof way back when?
No, I don't think, you know, I think in the instance of the western intersection off Ford Crossing where we're connecting up, that the challenge with that is it's really the sort of the high point of the site right now. So, you know, just by virtue of, you know, you're not gonna put the sanitary line down 10 feet necessarily. It's gotta work with everything else that's coming into it. That it just, by nature of the site, it just starts to come out of the ground, you know, as you go further north. The eastern one, it probably could have been a little bit deeper, but having been involved with this project from the start, I know all the constraints and the issues that you're running into. So, you know, it's at a typical depth, I guess, elevation for the sanitary, so I wouldn't necessarily say it was wrong. It's just, it's, you know, I think, you know, we knew from day one, looking at the entire campus, that at some point, you know, we can only take services so far,
right.
And that we're gonna have to do something up there. And, you know, we talked about an ejector station or a pump station and, you know, a bunch of other things, but this was the easiest way to handle it.
Okay,
thanks. I'm confused by the term trail. I would understand the word to mean a gravel or dirt mm-hmm. path going through the woods. But yet, and I've looked at the plans and read the written material and the letters from the neighbors. And I gather from that in your presentation that what you refer to as trails are actually, in the most cases, paved,
some
paved
of them are
walks
paved
going through the middle of the development with buildings on either side and so on.
Well, it's similar. I guess I'm classifying everything paved or not.
Just to clarify your point.
What's the difference between a trail and a sidewalk?
Well, I guess I'm thinking about the access road on the far eastern side of the site right now, which doesn't allow vehicle access. It's 10 feet wide, mm-hmm. It's 8 feet wide, it's paved. It's like a bike path, and it's a multimodal, you know, link to a lot of the other, you know, recreational opportunities throughout, you know, it goes down to the Mill River, it connects to the Smithfields, it goes, you know, across the street. There was a big trail network for, you know,
pedestrian network that was considered of and conceived of, and some of it, you know, part of the main Village Hill Road in the center of Village Hill, the 10-foot wide pedestrian and bicycle. I mean, that was part of the whole concept from day one, is that there was going to be these linkages. Some are on the street, some are between units. There's some that extend through condo developments, but somehow they've all got to connect.
And that's what you refer to as trails.
Yes. There are some existing trails that are gravel, that are going to stay gravel.
So the lengthy letter from the group of neighbors, I think, which I read a couple times, trying to understand it.
Sure.
I think they're talking about wanting to move the trails, quote unquote, to the perimeter so that they wouldn't feel like sidewalks. It would be more natural and through
sure.
the woods.
Sure.
Was that considered as an option?
It was. Couple things I'll just quickly point out is that one of the requirements, we're required. It's not something that we would love to put a gravel, 8-foot wide gravel path in on the top, but we're required by the overall permit conditions for Village Hill to provide a paved connection from the existing one up, to a point where it connects to the other, the remaining trail system on the north. So that's required. We've got to get an 8-foot wide paved path through there somehow. This side of the site, as I said, right now the current crossing is roughly here in that drainage swale. Everything on this side of the site is really quite steep. A lot of it was built up to make this detention system possible. And to be able to navigate around the eastern edge of the site, it gets very constraining. This is all heavily vegetated in here. But to be able to do that work and make that connection would just devastate that entire forest right now.
Well, an 8-foot wide path doesn't devastate vegetation.
But the fact that you've got to navigate grades that are 4-to-1 right now versus 8% for a certain period, there'd be a lot of regrading, a lot of vegetation removal. There's just no feasible way to do it. And we thought the best thing that we could do is try to bring it through some of the significant portions of the site, utilize as much of the existing, the old infrastructure that was there, a lot of the old roadbeds, so we don't have to construct, and excavate out entirely new trail systems, that we could, make these connections. And yes, some of them do go through and behind residential units, but they do all over the place on North Campus. So I think that was part of the trade-off up there, is that you get all these linkages and these connections on the North Campus, but just because of the sheer density, you can't avoid walking, past windows or by fences or, some different elements. So it's been a struggle to find that balance. But I think, in most cases, we've got an instance in this location where, we're relatively close to the homes, but for the remainder of it, you're really, quite a distance away, or enough distance away where, you can buffer it, you can screen it.
Yeah, so there are two different pedestrian and bike ped facilities that are required to be constructed at Village Hill and throughout the city, basically. The one that the connector that you're talking about, Jeff, through north-south, is a bicycle pedestrian facility. It has to be ADA compliant, and it has to be sturdy enough to be potentially cleared of snow, because it's meant to be a piece of transportation infrastructure for non-vehicular movement. The other piece are sidewalks that's connected to the street and connects to the building. So going back from the beginning of the original special permit for the planning board issue, there was a requirement that there be a bicycle pedestrian connection north, south, and east, west through the project. And yes, there are all these other trails that I would classify as non-paved surfaces that will remain, and they've been there for a very long time. And these new networks connect up to those trails, but these are there so that they are accessible for people using various modes.
Who does the snow removal?
The, well, at this point, we're not main, this, if it becomes a public trail, this, the city could opt to maintain them as they've, as the city has started to do for the main spine east-west through the city. But at this point, the city has no plan to do snow removal on any of the sort of connector routes, only the main lines.
So presumably the owners of the unit, are these condos?
They're single-family homes.
Okay, that's right. I'm sorry.
But there'll be an association because there will be maintenance requirements for the private street and for the stormwater infrastructure.
Right,
and
right,
then
okay.
there'll be sort of, there'll be a sub-association, and then they'll also be connected to the broader North Campus Homeowners Association.
So will that be a decision for the association, whether they choose to do snow removal on these paths?
I mean, they could. The one place where it will be removed is on the private driveway, because it's also that serves as the driveway to those
right.
units. But anything that's off the driveway or street network, they could opt to do that. I doubt they would. They are required to clear all the snow on the sidewalks, because that's a city ordinance.
Right. But on the trails, it would be their choice as an association.
Right.
City would not be obligated.
Other questions? Ready to open it up?
Yep. I wanted to make another, I had a couple more questions about the stormwater. So can you just clarify, I know Debbie made some comments in their statements about the stormwater, and it's great that you've designed a system that doesn't mandate the construction of a huge detention pond on the other side. There's still a pipe system, so in an LI, in a typical low impact development, all the water stays on site and doesn't use pipes or other hard sort of infrastructure for drainage. So DPW had a concern about the wet bottom nature of the swells and whether or not this will hold water, and will that be a maintenance problem for the association, presumably, if those stay wet over time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's sort of one question. And then what will happen if the check dams sort of settle over time? You said they're not very high, 6 to 8 inches. Or they somehow become degraded with people walking over them, or whatever reason that they might not stay perfectly in place. Will that then reduce the capacity of holding the water and then potentially affect the capacity in the detention pond?
Oh, wait, and I want to add one too, because it's in the same vein.
Yep.
There is also a comment that they are asking you to consider a whole portion of it to be lower because they're worried about it surviving winter temperatures?
Not sure, yeah. So I'll back up and try to answer the first question and just go through sort of how we arrived at where we did. So the whole notion of LID, low impact development, I think one of our arguments all along has been that the goal or the objectives of the LID elements are to provide really a toolbox of different things you can do to a stormwater system. And all of it, some of them are for treatment, some of it are for stormwater storage, some of them for, they're the different tools are for different things. But the intention is to use that toolbox, and select those elements that are appropriate for the site to reduce the need and the demand on a conventional pipe system. So I would a little bit disagree that it doesn't, LID means no pipes, that, some of the LID tools that, are in the handbook include pipe systems. I mean, there's a dry bottom basin, or a dry bottom swale, which is a sort of the sister of what we're proposing. But in that case, it involves excavating out 4 feet or so of existing soil, lining it
if you don't have enough groundwater depth to achieve what you need, putting a sub drain in there, putting stone, fabric, engineered soil, you know, all the way up to the right. So, you know, that's still an LID method, but it uses a pipe system, and that pipe system has got to go somewhere. So that's, you know, we're in a position with this project where we're trying to employ as much LID as appropriate and we have space for on the site, but recognize that there's also a subdivision standard, there's also, you know, safety and drainage concerns that we've got to answer to. So, you know, it does eventually have to leave the site and get out and connect to a, you know, a engineered drainage system. So it's sort of a hybrid of the two, but I think that's what the objectives of low impact development is to try and reduce the need to put catch basins in the roadway every 200 feet, and that's the end of the story, that, you know, there's some other elements that you can do. So the situation that we ran into up here, we did test pits, soil test pits, to determine groundwater depth in April, I think, of this year. At that time, there was a lot of frozen ground, there were a lot of standing puddles up in this upper part of the site. As soon as they dug a lot of these pits, you know, water would just sort of rush in because it was the thawed horizon was only a foot deep, so it would just sort of pour into the hole. As I alluded to earlier, it was a real hodgepodge of material, everything from structural backfill to, you know, virgin soil to what used to be pavement base under a parking lot or roadway. It was a whole range of things. Because of how they've got to determine, because of how they are required to determine groundwater, in April they determined groundwater was only 3 feet down in some instances. But, you know, we all looked at each other after that report came back and said, this is the top of the world, the majority of it's gravel, how can it be at 3 feet? So, you know, we waited, we designed a system, we had a lot of conversations with the DPW. So groundwater, we did do borings later on, within the last month or two. They didn't find any evidence of water in any of the holes down to 8 or 9 feet. Which is consistent with all the borings that were done for Ford Crossing at the time was done. And that was a lot more indicative of what we would have expected to see, is groundwater down at those depths. You know, maybe you get a perched water table or something during the wettest times of the year, but there's really no water going to this. This is the top of the hill and it drops off in every direction. So then we're left with, you know, what do we use for an LID tool that's appropriate for this? We don't have the space for a big wide rain garden to size it for the amount of water that was going to it. We are very limited space-wise with what we could do. The swales, you know, vegetated swales, wet bottom swales, there's a number of, you know, those types of things that were appropriate because that's the space that we've got. We've got, you know, some, you know, it's substantial space, I'll call it, in that tree belt from the sidewalk to the curb. So one of the elements that they describe is this wet bottom swale. It's for cases where you know you don't have 2 or 3 feet of groundwater separation below those swales. And again, we have to defer back to these soil test pits that were done with said groundwater is at 3 feet. Every other test and every other indication that we have says it's down deeper, but DPW wasn't, you know, convinced that we could say, okay, that the groundwater is at 3 feet, these can be dry bottom swales. The other complication, as soon as we called them dry bottom swales, it requires that sub drain, it requires all that material to be removed, engineered soil to be brought in. It sort of defeated the purpose of what we were really trying to do, which is really trying to figure out a way to, you know, get water off and treat it.
So you're not amending any of the soils around the area drains? Okay.
No, we don't need to. And that, again, if we follow the Mass Stormwater Handbook, the guidelines for designing a wet bottom swale. These weirs are designed of stone. I mean, they're intended to be stone. I think part of the maintenance, long-term operation maintenance, it may be, you know, monitoring these, repairing them as needed, just to speak to your point, just like you clean out a catch basin. But they're really very shallow depths. They're intended to be porous so that, you know, because these swales all go down gradient and there's a drain at the very end, we're not concerned that you're going to have standing water for long periods of time. I mean, we think, A, the soils are, the textural analysis of the soils is such that they are going to infiltrate something.
They're not, you know, they're not solid clay. It's not, you know, they're not impermeable. The check dams are all permeable, so, you know, even if water does temporary pond, it will make its way through the stone. And then we do have a drain at the end, which is at grade, so anything that makes it to the end will go into that drain and, you know, out of the system. So there's a lot of research that's been done at the University of New Hampshire and other stormwater institutions that, you know, show these things do work in the winter despite, you know, everybody's, you know, including mine, you know, apprehension about, but there's been a lot of studies that, you know, water does find its way through the system, so.
Aren't we being a little contradictory if we're asking to move toward low impact development and now we've got a system like that and now we're questioning, well, what if it fails and how do you know it's going to work? And so we're saying on one hand, this is the way you want to do it, and then they do it and they say, well, not so fast. So couldn't it just be part of the association agreement for maintenance and so forth?
It could be. I think the issue really is, you know, it's really site specific, so you have to look at the soils and the depth of groundwater and all that stuff. So I think the issue isn't we want it, but we don't want it. It's we want it, but we have to be careful because it has to be designed specifically for that site. So those are the questions that DPW is raising. It's not that they don't want it. It's just this is a very tricky site because, and the fact that soils aren't being amended. But essentially they're piping the system anyway, so any overflow is going to go to the detention pond.
Yeah, my concern is that the piping, it serves its purpose of being only an overflow, that it's not,
right,
you know,
it's not.
We don't know what the catch basins are going to do right now, and so there's no sort of validation work. You do your test boring, you do your design according to standards, and then you say, I hope that takes care of most of the water, because if it doesn't, I've got a pipe that does, but I think that's DPW saying, I don't want that pipe to have to take it all.
Right, but I think the other piece is about the treatment and the different ways, you know, you can pick little pieces of it. It's not an entire system based on a non, you know, a gray water or pipe system, but there will be some infiltration. There will be certainly the water running through grass swales is better than running along the curb edge right into the catch basin.
I have such admiration for all of you that have watched us discuss sewer water for 2 hours.
I just ask Carolyn a quick question.
Yes.
The number of units, Carolyn, mm-hmm. it's permitted or allowed for 285, right, plus the 83 units of assisted living.
No, it's not. The master plan allows 327 units is sort of the cap plus 80 plus or minus assisted living units.
Okay.
So when all is said and done, if this gets built out and if the next project in the northwest corner gets built out, then we'd be at about 285.
Okay, and what about the provision for development of the historic buildings? Are any of them developed at this point? For residential?
Yes.
I gather that's over and above the cap.
Mm-hmm. Well, the 285 counts the renovation of the nurses' homes. There are two buildings that have 33 units in them that were originally there. But the redevelopment, any residential units in the only other buildings left would be the male attendance building and the coach house things. And so those could be residential units. And this is for construction of new development. So it was encouraged that there was a reuse and mixed use of the historic buildings. Of course, all the historic buildings on the South Campus were taken out and originally, right. the city was encouraging the mixed use of those, and those wouldn't have counted.
Well, the 285, though, I'm confused. Does that include or not include units in the historic buildings?
No. I'm sorry. The 285 includes the nurses' home, the 33 units that are in the former, were referred to as the nurses' homes. I think that's right. Pat Goggins is here. He might be able to tell me what they were called officially. But those two dorm buildings that are there now on Village Hill Road I counted those in the 285.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Okay, one quick question, and that is the traffic plan that's referred to in the DPW response, is that traffic plan back when we had 207 units in the original plan before we upped the number to 327?
No, well, I have to look at DPW's comments because I'm not sure which one you're referring to, but there was a whole revision of the entire MEPA filing to look at the addition of 100 units.
Okay.
Or 100 plus
I'll
units.
Let you look at that.
Yeah.
Maybe we'll open mm-hmm. it up. My concern is if we have increased the density and we're still using an old traffic plan, I want a new one.
No, we're not.
Okay.
But I'll pull that.
And just one last quick thing before I leave, ever opened up. Just a note of clarification. So the northern part of the campus that isn't going to be developed is all going to be deeded to the city. It's not going to have a CR, but it'll be deeded to the city. So just to clarify that point.
Okay. I would like to open it up for public comment. Yes? Hope so.
I have some visuals that Carolyn, I saw it was on the...
It's on the screen. It's in the lower. If you can escape, Jeff, out of there.
Yep.
I just minimize them, so they're on the bar. And your thumb drive is right there if you want to grab it. It's already open down on the bottom, so you don't have to reopen it.
I see. Is it this one?
I don't know. You gave me three.
Yes.
So. Okay. So would you give us your name and address?
So my name is John Brady. I live at 85 Olander Drive. And I was one of the drafters and signers of that letter that Alan Gerson referred to. We residents adjacent to this proposed development are very happy on Village Hill. We really appreciate all that's been done there. And we really do enjoy living in the site. And we have a couple of things that we'd like you to think about as you're approving, considering this proposal that affects the quality of life as we see it. Here's the Google Earth view. And in particular, I'd like to talk about the trails and the access to the green space. So I know we just talked about three different kinds of trails, the mandated trail, the sidewalks, and then the trails in the woods. And it's really the trails in the woods that we'd like to, or that I'd like to talk about because they get lots of use. These are the trails, almost all of the yellow there, except for the part in the lower right, are just paths in the woods. Some are old roads, some are the gravel things that Alan Burson was talking about. And they get lots of use. The problem that we see is that There's green space that we can get to now, and at least the part in green is that's the 200 foot away from the river we think is public, but we're worried about this piece of property, which in the plan, not what we just heard perhaps, is all being transferred from Mass Development to the Transformations group. So you can see that it covers a lot of those trails. So we'd like to make sure that we will still have access to the green space and can be assured of that access through time. It's not just us, but other residents who might want to get there. I would just point out that in purple there is the other proposed development which is already on the planning board site, which we'll be considering in the future, which also blocks some of this access. I tried to superimpose where all those buildings were on this so you could see it, and then also the Picoy development that's being proposed. The multi-use trail, the mandated trail that Jeff was just talking about, takes you into the middle of their site. So in terms of walking through the woods, it really isn't that. It's not the appreciation of the green space that the trail coming from Smith College that you see up there above is. we would like to see access along the two red lines that you can see. The one on the left is very much what Jeff was talking about. So I think it's a proposal that's in agreement with the developer. But we'd like to make sure that it's an easement or in some way is in the public hands. So it's not just a trail across their property that might or might not be available to residents over time. The trail on the right is the along the right-hand side of that drainage to the lower detention basin, which is very easily walkable as it stands. With modest modification, it could be even more easily walkable. It would be difficult maybe to make it ADA, it would be more expensive to make it accessible in that way. But I don't think it is a difficult trail to have. And once again, it's on land that won't be public land. It's on the land that is being transferred to EPH. So what we'd like to see is that those two corridors be made, and I don't know what the right legal way to do it is, an easement somehow so that we get access to that space. We heard moments ago that all of maybe that green space there will be transferred to the city, which is one of the things we asked for in that letter, and so we think that's really good. But I do think we need to ensure that there's public access to those trails on either side, and being on the outside is different than walking between the buildings. It really is a very different experience, and it's one that we've enjoyed and would like to be able to continue to do.
Thank you. I was a little concerned when you had thumb drive with graphics, but that didn't take too long. Thank you. Appreciate it.
There's the close-up of the trail along the side. I forgot to show that. That's where approximately where we go.
All right. Yes, sir.
Could I follow up on
that? Sure.
Can you follow on this?
Yeah, I think
okay.
So.
My name's Nick Warren. I'm actually John's neighbor on 79 Old Langer Street. And I want to just pick up on a piece that John talked about briefly, which is the proposed multi-use trail, which that purple arrow is pointing to. Jeff, could I borrow your zapper? I promise I won't zap anybody. And I should, and full disclosure, I'm obviously a, how does it go? Just a little button?
It's just a little button.
Ha! Perfect. Okay. I'm one of the houses along Olander, so that this field that I'm particularly concerned with and want to talk to you a little bit about is my backyard. The purple arrow that you see there is the proposed trail now, more or less. You'll notice this is on the old, this is on what is called the master plan, which is not really up to date. Most of it still has a school over on the left, and this is obviously not the co-housing development that Jeff has showed you. But it gives you enough of an idea of what is proposed to happen, which is that this trail, what the purple arrow is pointing to, basically it doesn't bisect the field, but it runs right through it. And I want to be quite clear that field is actually, it's a gem. It's a real treasure in this development. And these treasures are in short supply in the internal being of this development. We have Beechtree Park, which is this thing right here. We have a little teeny one over here in Pequoy, which I think is lovingly called a pocket park. I'm not quite sure what that's about. And there's the land here, down here, between the two, Carolyn was talking about, the nurses' buildings that have been turned into apartments. That's it. Otherwise, we have extremely dense development, denser than what you see here. There's a lot going on. So part of my plea is, can we figure out a way to keep this very sweet field not bisected by not just a trail, but by the multi-use trail, which is 8 feet wide, 8% grade or less, depending upon how long it is. And we have some thoughts about how one could do that. I guess I'm contradicting a little bit what Jeff was presenting, because I think, although I do realize a lot of thought has been put into creating this grade, Jeff talked quite a bit about it, we think that there are ways to do it, and I'd like to propose that we explore a little bit what those ways might be. So this park, and you've actually seen from Jeff's presentation how pretty that field is. You know, it's nice. It's got grass. It's green, which is in short supply in our development right now. It's got deer. It has hawks. It's got a whole lot of nice things. That's all. I'm not going to appeal to your...
Red fox.
Pardon?
Red fox.
Red fox. We got foxes. We've got muskrats. We got a lot of frogs. We get a pair of green herons. It's not crucial to you, but what is crucial to us is that the essentially cutting up that field is going to really change not only the character of the field, but we think will also change the use of that field by wildlife. So
well, the one advantage for that trail, though, it goes back up behind the fountain, which is a park, which is one of the parks.
It is going, yes, and you're right, and it is going, and that I think is mandated actually that it goes, that it somehow ends up at the memorial park, right. A teeny little park. That's another pocket park, but it's a park.
Major trees, major, yeah.
Yeah, it's got stuff. But you'll notice this actually was an earlier plan as to how that might be done. And if you see my purple arrow again, and the red outline is the same, the idea was at that point to run it up much closer to the co-housing, up into the into this corridor of trees. It has to go all the way up to the private road, has to go over to the Old Lander Extension and then down before it gets you to the Memorial Park. It does get to the park, but it does it in a fairly circuitous way. I don't think circuity, if that's a word, is a problem in development as long as we can get things from here to there. So the point being that if we could find a way to maintain this the integrity of that park, it would be for us quite valuable. And I think more specifically, you'll have to pardon the fact I can't do curved lines the way John does. But I'm proposing the purple arrow is the present proposal, which you'll notice runs right under the canopy of those two big beech trees up there off of Old Lander. I think if it's this raised part, if it's wood, that will be less of a problem. I didn't realize that was a plan until now. But we were proposing that, in fact, you see the green line here, which goes along the existing road, which is behind a screen of trees, down fairly close to where it crosses the swale that runs between the two detention ponds. It can then loop back in better than I've drawn here in green, then loop again up here, a little bit to the east of those beech trees, and run into that pile of trees that's in there. I think, and this is, it would need engineering thinking, that we can get the grade, get the 8% grade that we need. We can save a lot of that field. Now, ideally, it'd be great if the multi-use trail didn't even run up that way. If we have a multi-use trail, which is Village Hill Road on the left. So if we thought of what could we do if we actually expanded the sidewalk on Olander Street and had the east side trail be right there, right down the street. That's not going to happen. But it would be really nice if there were ways to do it. So that is the, there we go. This is back to John.
Pick one more.
Okay.
One more.
Oh, yeah. This is just showing the two possibilities. This is the existing plan. This is the proposal that I was making. And actually, we're actually proposing that this section of it be more to the east. So it's not under those beech trees, but more in this area here. I'm proposing more study of it.
Thank you.
That's basically it.
Next.
Quickly.
Yes.
Carolyn, for site plan review, what constraints do we have as far as layout relative to this particular issue of trails and so forth?
Well, this part of the subdivision development, I think this is all detention pond area. This is a detention pond lot. It's not going to be public open space. The city doesn't want it because it's a maintenance area. So that's not open space. So the idea was really to work along the existing roadbed so there's very little impact that you'd have to recreate because you're coming along here and just taking, again, you heard the grade issue, but that field is created because of the original detention pond there. And
you know, a surface level path is not going to ruin a field. I don't think you're still going to have deer there and hawks. But, and there was also the issue about where it crosses the open channel. So that's why it was pulled back. But at any rate, we still need the connection going down. This open space is going to come to the city. You heard that this trail connection is still going to be there. It'll be part of this development. And the goal, ultimately, is to create an ADA-accessible path to cross the river. So this will not always be gravel down here. We hope it takes a lot of money, and we have to figure out how we're going to get a bridge across the river. But, you know, that's one of the, and this would be part of the open space as part of the whole master plan. So that part, I think, has been addressed. We just haven't seen it in plan yet.
Well, I think the advantage of presenting it is they're listening. I mean, that's the point of this, too. So, yes.
It's a question. I'm confused. Isn't the field and the proposed trail that Mr. Warren was just discussing outside the area of the subdivision application?
So yes, but that's the issue. That's the problem when you have this master developer and creates the plan and the board approves it, and then there are little pieces that are developed over time. You have to connect the dots. So it's not there. Mass development has to bring the trail up from where they finished it to this project point, and so there's a negotiation about who's going to do that. It's not, you know, the city's responsibility. But so it is outside of the project boundaries, but it has to get connected because that's the overall master plan, is to connect those pieces.
But is that within our scope of discussion tonight?
Yes, because you want to make sure that the master plan gets completed the way it was envisioned, the way it was originally approved, that we're going to have these multi-purpose trail connections. And one of the reasons why it's a little circuitous here is because there's this huge drop-off here. I mean, there's a steep slope here. So originally, so the east-west connector comes across Ford Crossing. It does a little bit of meandering through this park, which you guys negotiated. But it originally the intent was to come right through here and connect and cross over and then down. But the grade is so significant here, you could slab up this lot, but Mass Development has determined that they want to sell that as a building lot. So that's not a place that can, I mean, there isn't the historic road comes up here, but so the way to make it ADA accessible is to go to sort of either go up and around or to come, you know, at an angle up here. There will be, as you saw the plans for the Memorial Park, there will be a path connecting from here to the park. It won't be ADA, it won't be 8 feet wide, it'll be 4 feet gravel.
Well, but I gather the applicant doesn't own or control the land that we've been talking about. So how could, what if hypothetically we wanted to require that be done? I mean, isn't that impossible?
The overall Mass Development's required to make sure that this connection gets made. So it's whatever negotiation Mass Development has with with transformations and in their negotiation to sell the property. So it's Mass Development's responsibility. Mass Development owns the land now. Mass Development is only going to sell the property outline that you've seen, but nevertheless, when you're approving a project, you have to make sure those connections get made. So that's where your jurisdiction is, and yes, you have the jurisdiction to say you have to show how you're connecting that.
Yeah, I want to add one thing. It is true that if we do push it to the north, that does go onto transformations land, so it actually is within their line.
Thank you. You're actually number two because we got interrupted, and I said nodded to Mr. Wright to comment next.
Those technical glitches that you complimented others on not.
Everybody brought
a flash
drive tonight.
I have a little flash drive. Do I just stick it in, or do I just stick it in there? It's not my forte. I'm Jonathan Wright. We live at 91 Olander Drive. And where's the little squeezy thing?
Which is the
Technical term.
John always assists me with these things.
I don't know.
You can close the window.
Close which window?
This one, the one that...
Stop here. Click here. Don't want this one.
I just was...
Mr. Ryder, what's your address? I know it's Orlander. What's your address?
91 Olander Drive.
Thank you.
Very thoughtful. Okay. All right. So we live at 91 Olander Drive, and just to orient you, we are the last house currently on Olander Drive. Adjacent to us to the north is the Memorial Park, and one very simple thing I want to, this is the cartoon on the face of the proposal, and this line here has been moved around a good deal. In the most recent version, it comes down and then crosses over behind the back of our property and the back of the Brady's property. And there doesn't seem to be, it's not the way it's cartooned here, it's not the way it's been presented previously, and it doesn't seem to be any reason to do that. We would prefer that this remained open space as it has been represented to us for the last 7 years. So that's one request, very simple item there. Before I go on, I want to begin by really expressing my admiration for the developer for bringing forward a net zero project, having been involved in this work for 35 years. This is not easy, and something really to be celebrated. We do have some questions here, and I want to just walk you through them. Okay, so in this piece of graphics, you will see the street layout. This is a new urbanist project. Everything that has been done to date has been based on the principles of new urbanism, which is street-facing porches. Porches have been required of all developers and builders. There's a maximum distance from the houses to the street. And street-facing garages have been prohibited. Now, Jeff told you, Jeff I admire greatly, has told you that those constraints of the sites didn't allow them. But what we've ended up with here is a pretty standard suburban curve. And when I show you some of the designs later, you'll see that there are virtually no porches facing the street, and most of the houses face into the common areas. So the fundamental principles of new urbanism are not presented here. And it's all about the size of the lots and so on, but some of the people in this room have expended tens, hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars to meet the design requirements, and we feel pretty strongly those requirements should be expected of everyone else who delivers there. And this is the planting plan that Jeff showed you, and I could be mistaken here because this is a street landscape plan. But in the presentations, I saw very little landscaping relative to the individual buildings. And again, it's a requirement at site plan approval that all of the landscaping be shown and that all of the architecture be shown. So there's not much here. I want to draw your attention. This is called Parcel 1, and it was Carolyn mentioned the lot where there currently is a steep drive that drops down here, through here. This is the Memorial Park is here, and this is the co-housing component. So I want to draw your attention to that parcel because we being right builders, are moments away from executing an LDA, and we could be back to you for a net zero, the platinum home for the site. So that's maybe news to the developer, and we want to just share that at this time. Here's parcel one. Okay. this is the these are the two sentinel beech trees. The middle of these is a 27-inch pignut hickory that's actually failing. But we want to have a condition presented here that this proximity, these are solar canopies, I think, it's parking, that there be new tree buffer put in here. Now, the proponent may not have known that this was going to be developed this way, that's fine, but we do think that the proximity of this parking is a bit problematic. This is our property here. There is going to be a pathway of some kind that comes up and circles through here, as was mentioned, for access to the Memorial Park. This is the planting that's shown, and it, see if I can, well, this is not going to show it very well. They have provided some screening plantings here from the Memorial Park to kind of supplement the natural growth there, and we just would ask that it be extended to the north as well.
Jonathan, on that plan, can
yes.
you slide up again?
Because yep.
there's some plantings around the edge of the parking field.
Yes, if you look at those are low plantings. Those are.
So you're saying you're
there should be this should be, there should be some grove of trees of some kind. In the further up in this, I'm not sure I show it very well here, and I apologize. This slide, I don't show it, but this multi-use path that leaves the beech tree area and moves up through here is actually overlaid directly on the travel path of the automobiles. It uses the driveway and passes between the co-housing homes on the right and the garages on the left. So it's actually a little worse than what John Brady mentioned. There really isn't a multi-use path. They're walking down the middle of a street. And it's not a good piece. You also would have you, and I guess it's up to the fire department, but there is no fire truck access to the most sides of most of the co-housing buildings. And the fire department requires a full equipment access to one side of every residential unit. I don't know what's going on with that, whether that's been reviewed, but that is required. It has been required. There was one. So the design guidelines for Village Hill buildings are about this thick, CBT, and the research was to suggest that Village Hill should represent the cross-section of the four main periods of abundant residential architecture in Northampton: Colonial, Greek Revival, Craftsman, and Victorian. And we've all been expected to do that, and I just look at these, and if you look at all of the pieces, you'll see there are no porches, and these are essentially boxes. Now, I don't mean that entirely pejorative, but they're all the same. Some have differences of trim, but they don't meet the architectural guidelines. Excuse me. This is another version. This is a ranch house. There's no reference to the architectural style here. Another version of a colonial, different size corner boards, otherwise the same. Take a look at that. Sorry about that. Coming through the other way, standing on its head. Another version of the same buildings. I think this is I'm not sure, but this building is about 85 feet long, 84 feet long. That's it. So I just wanted to close by saying I have a lot of admiration for the net zero portion of this. We have real concerns about the walkways. We have concerns about the front-loading garages, the absence of porches, which we've been told will be optional. They shouldn't be optional. It's part of what the community is designed around. And we have those minor concerns about plantings and other pieces.
Thank you
very much.
Sir?
My name is Ken Dim. I'm also on Olanda Drive. These are my neighbors.
We all commuted together.
What's that?
commuted together tonight, didn't we?
Well, actually, we did. We did not. We used all used separate gas. I agree with everything that's been said. I just want to make one connection, though. It seems to me everything what we've been talking about is has to do with access to trails, access to green space, et cetera, new urbanism. One of the things that we have not mentioned, though, and what's it really is a question of mine, is the relationship between all of that and the number of houses, the number of residential units. And Alan Burson brought it up earlier. With all of what I've seen in terms of looking at the past planning board minutes and CAC minutes and mass development, it started up at 200 units, and then a number of years ago it was 327. And I never saw any connection or saying that did not take into account assisted living. And then recently that's been said that assisted living units do not count as residential units, and I'm not quite sure why. People live there, that's not an institution, it's voluntary. So I don't know why that would not count as residential units. And if that does count, then we're closer to 400 units, and that seems to me to put everything that ties together a lot of what we've been talking about, because when you get more and more units, you get less and less access to green space and trails, et cetera. So.
Yes.
My name is Betsy Nicoletti, and I live on Usanti Drive, and I'm delighted to live in Northampton. I'm a new member of the community, and I look forward to welcoming other new members to our Village Hill community. My concern is about this traffic. Currently, with our current residents and current construction workers, and what's going to happen in the future. And what I would like to see is some speed bumps on Village Hill Road and on the three parallel roads so that everybody just slows down, because I think it's a safety hazard. The second thing, I called the city, of course, get to a new town, call the city and complain, but I called the city because when the Pequoy houses go up, they put the cellar holes in without any fencing. And when I called and complained, the next day some little yellow tape went up. And yellow tape isn't going to keep a child from falling in. So those are the two safety issues that I have about current and future development.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Jay Brynes. I do not live on Orlando Drive. I live on Mosier Street, which is on the west side of the development. So I would like to address two or three points. And again, everything that was said so far, I think, has the sentiment of the entire neighborhood, the whole village community. We're all enjoying living there, and also we would welcome additional people to come there. We're not trying to keep people out. But the more we separate ourselves from the woods, which is why most of us went there, the more that's becoming a problem. So that as development keeps raising the cap and the ceiling on how many units are there, and then where the roads are and where the cutoffs are, we're more and more being isolated from the green area. On the west side, we understand that right next to this development will be a Pequoy proposal. Pequoy's housing, as I've seen them on their proposal, and the transformation housing are coming very close to each other. They're really squeezing out all of the land in between them to get both developments in. We have wonderful access to the woods on the west side. That's gone under the Pequoy / transformation proposal. So that's a major problem for the Westie guys, okay? These two guys have their own issues. They have the deer and the hawks and everything else. But we have some wonderful access into the woods, and we'd like to preserve that. The specimen trees we talked about earlier, well, we all appreciate them. They are aging trees, and I think in the presentation, Mr. Squires mentioned that some of them are already coming to their end. Preserving trees that won't be there in 10 or 15 years is not, to me, a goal of this project. I believe we need to add new trees or new supports to those trees so that we actually can get real live and large trees in that neighborhood. We're building low trees because of the solar gain issues, and we're cutting off all the magnificent trees that area used to have. So I think we need to address the tree issue. the city of Northampton is on record of trying to get more trees and growing trees. I think we're cutting down more trees in Village Hill than we're adding to the rest of the city. So we're, our net inventory is probably declining rather than increasing. So I'd like us to pay attention to the trees. While we like the specimen trees, that's not our future. Those, they're already failing. So that, and that was in 2000, when it's now 15 years later. I think a new approach to that concept needs to be considered at this point. Thank you.
Kellen, could you just respond to the question about the number of units and assisted living? Explain that.
Yeah, I mean, going back to the original NEPA filing, going back in late 1999, 2000, there were identified categories of uses: industrial, commercial, including retail and office, housing, housing off-site at Ice Pond, housing on the premise, and then this option, potentially, of assisted living units. Assisted living box was placed on the master plan in a different location than it is now early on, but it was sort of had its own category. So there were originally, there was about 400,000 square feet of commercial space, assisted living units, 207, you know, residential units. The commercial space has almost been cut in half. The residential units, the cap went up, but again, the assisted living units was always a separate category. It wasn't part of that original number.
So when you say the cap went up, is it fair to say that decision has already been made?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Then who makes that decision?
Well, there were a number of parties involved in that. At the local level, the Citizens Advisory Committee, which was originally established to oversee the development of the master plan. Originally, when the master plan was built, there was a built-in flexibility in the Citizens Advisory Committee definition of sort of how this would proceed. There was a built-in 10% allowance, so any 10% change could happen without going back to the Citizens Advisory Committee. Planning Board approved the master plan and the special permit, so it had to go to the Planning Board to approve additional units. And then there's this whole MEPA filing that was based on a certain number of units and a certain square footage of commercial.
MEPA stands for?
The Environmental Policy Act filing for when you have major construction. There are different things that trigger that, but basically anytime you have a big construction project, you also have to file at the state and get the state environmental review. It's a lengthy process. So if you make modifications from that, then you have to go back to the state and show what impact the changes are, if it's a reduction or if it's an increase, and then what mitigation you're going to do to address those impacts that you've identified. And it's not just traffic, it's water, it's sewer, it's
so was the
Citizens housing.
Advisory Committee, did they pass judgment on increasing?
Yes, that was in 2010. It went to the Citizens Advisory Committee, went to the Planning Board, and then finally there was a MEPA amendment, and so the state approved that increase.
In the end, this is a very general statement, but is it fair to say that this portion of the campus, if you squint your eyes and kind of look back at the original master plan, it's within shouting distance of that density of that initial plan, and versus originally it was supposed to be basically dense in the middle of the campus, and as you moved out it got
right.
less dense, and this little nook of the campus, it's more or less represents what the initial plan did.
Right.
Where we lost the plan, I think, was the density in the middle.
Right. There's not the same amount of density.
Right.
There are more units, but it's spread out.
Right.
More. And again, the original master plan was preservation of hundreds of acres on the surrounding outlying area. There was never a requirement that there had to be multiple pocket parks of various size, or big pockets versus little pockets, because the big goal from the city's perspective was to create this village center that was, you know, dense, mixed use,
in walking, you know, accessible to downtown, but surrounded by open space.
Not as much open space as it was originally planned.
No, there is. There's more open space because they've created that Oak Park and they've created the Beach Park or whatever they're calling the little parks in between is more than what had originally been planned for this core part of the campus. And there's still the same amount on the exterior.
So I'd like to take folks that haven't had a comment cycle yet. So yes, sir, you have up to name and address.
All right, Danielle, 71 Olander. And just two things I'd like to reiterate, that whole idea of going for a walk in the woods, you know, and the path around the periphery just seems to be an essential part that you want to get sometimes away from the density. And the idea that we get on the path, go out, and then just cut back into civilization. If I wanted to do that, I would have walked the sidewalk up Olander. I mean, it seems like a strange thing to have to cut back in to go back out again. And the other question was about the traffic. By count, we probably have about 21 houses and townhomes right now on Olander. We're like four times now as many up in this development, weighted heavily toward the Olander side. The other part of the U is, you know, some, but not a lot. Is the plan appropriate? I mean, is the streets able to handle that traffic? Or are we going to become just sort of this major thoroughfare? That's just a concern of mine that we have.
I have a question that does follow on to that. I originally saw the streets at 24 in width and wondered for this section of road that is not a throughfare at all, I would have considered maybe 20 feet wide streets. So what guidance are they following that doesn't respond to taking those streets down for slower traffic?
So it follows the 24 feet wide is the standard for residential yield streets, 30 feet from the intersection. We're supposed to narrow down. So when you're entering, it's supposed to be 20 feet wide. That's a waiver request that you guys haven't discussed yet. It's pretty major because this is a brand new subdivision regulations, and so we'll get to that in a minute. But the other piece of it is, you know, it may not be a gridded street, but certainly the curve along the north end is will slow traffic down. We do allow on-street parking, so again, it's that residential yield street, so if there's on-street parking, you know, you're going to have to slow for that. They've also narrowed it. Again, they're asking for a waiver to install a gravel sidewalk on one side that the Owners Association will maintain, but that's because they're incorporating an LID, one LID component, so they're asking to fall under that provision of the subdivision regs. That does require crossing across Olander every 200 feet to sort of break up that block. DPW never likes mid-block crossings, so they haven't shown one here, but as an alternative, they're showing a narrowing of the street to 20 feet in this section here in lieu of providing crosswalk. So that piece, you know, the sort of a restriction in the road there would act as another mechanism. But the openings here, the argument is Mass Development put the curb cuts in there, so they're just going to go with it instead of trying to put a raised intersection or a speed table even further back or narrowing the throat of that opening the way the subdivision regs would require.
Could we require on the east side where it crosses right there, can that be erased? I mean, can that be one of our conditions to make that a raised wall, which would serve the same purpose as a speed bump? It would be a raised table. We have some around town that work sometimes better than others.
Yeah, I mean, I guess you'd want to know, I mean, what the there is a crosswalk there already. There is drainage to consider, and I don't know that it would warrant you know, you'd want to raise the intersection to slow vehicles. I think the issue at the intersection is people coming in or out of would be slowed as they turn, so they're not just whipping around the corner in either direction. When you're up here, you already have the crosswalk, so I'm not sure that it's necessary
at
that point.
Yeah, but his recent concern was that they're not slowed if they're using Orlando for the entry and exit. So it's not necessarily that turning, it's the ones that aren't turning.
But I don't think that's where you would, you know, if you're slowing here, by the time you get down here, you have plenty of time to speed up if you are inclined to do that.
More comments? Jonathan? No, first, yeah. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Beth Gramps Haxby. I right now live at 370 Spring Street, but I've recently purchased one of the flats on one of the new buildings at Village Hill, and we're very excited to be moving in there, and I'm pleased to have a chance to talk with you. I just wanted to mention one thing, and that is, or maybe two, addressing the fact that the Village Hill Road enters Route 66, there's a stoplight there, and the traffic that is, you know, going to be coming down Olander is probably all going to be heading out that one access. There is another way out onto the Little Prince Street, I think it's called, from Burt's Pit. But I just want to mention that we have a lot of development that's happening back there that is sort of funneled into one. And then the other thing is that I'm not a builder, I don't have a long history with this, but my understanding is that the numbers, you know, have really increased a great deal since the master plan, and I know you're talking about having watched that happen little by little and overseen it, but I do feel like it would be important to keep looking back at how does this affect what the intent was with the great number, you know, increased spots.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Going once, going twice, Mr. Wright.
I just wanted to add a comment based on what Mr. Sullivan asked. You know, when you pull back, is this roughly what we saw? And in understanding that the master plan is always been conceptual, it's always been market responsive, and Mass Development has had their work cut out for them to respond to that. But in the master plan that has been extant, there are 45 units. This is 66 buildings and 82 units. It's a very different level of density. And part of the reason that there are such constraints for the walkways through here and pieces through there is that, you know, there are not seven homes in the area that's being proposed for co-housing. There are 32. And I'm not sure that the design intent has been satisfied. The comments about traffic are addressed to doubling the numbers of units over a period of time against expectation. There's flexibility there. It's not just the cap, it's the traffic patterns, it's the use patterns, the construction, and so on. So it has doubled. This is twice.
I understand. I would say most pointedly, though, that what we missed was the density of the center village. That's the numbers are because we've spread them out. I mean, I hear you that this last piece obviously isn't the numbers we intended, but, you know, what we really wanted was the density of the core that is now lost to us in a way.
I'd like to take that actually to a little bit in a different path. You know, I think you all have heard many times from Mass Development that it's a conceptual plan. You can't go on the plan and count the number of units. That it's conceptually, here are detached units in this area, here are attached units in this other area, and if we detach the units in this area, it's okay because it was conceptual. I mean, the same thing could be said for any part of the campus. So Mass Development consistently said, don't count the boxes that are on our master plan.
I agree, but I think conceptually it was dense and less dense.
Yes,
you know? So it wasn't a number of boxes, it was just a holistic kind of approach.
And right.
So, okay.
Yeah, I remember when we had a very strong discussion about, you know, workforce housing and low-income housing and, you know, making this a mixed community. And so I think we've lost, you know, some things that we had hoped to get there, but.
The parcels that have been developed and have been there for 10 years have been developed to the densest possible allowed by fire separation. We're building the only three-story residences there, so I would say that's I would disagree that we've lost the density in the core.
You have 55-foot wide lots at Pequoy. You have barely, you know, room for a tree line between them. So I don't know. Yes, there are parks, but you would have lost the trees. The assisted living is 60 some odd units.
83.
That was you know, scheduled for 18 townhomes. So I think it's actually gone the other way.
Okay. Yes, sir. Wait, is anyone else wanting to speak who hasn't had a chance? I'd really love to get all the first round in before we start repeats. Standing, put them off. Come on up.
So I don't know what the overall process is going forward, and I appreciate there's been a long, long history of this development, and I think everybody's worked real hard to get us to where we are today. So the question I have is about where do we go from here? We are looking at proposed significant additional development. The people who now live in Village Hill have no real say in this process. A lot's been done historically. We're trying to follow some of the guidelines and the rules. There was a citizen advisory board. None of us have been part of that. Now that we're here, we would love, I think, in communication with Mass Development, you folks, whatever the appropriate bodies are, to really sit down and say, here's what we'd like to see. Because we're now living here, and what was planned 15 years ago has sort of come to be a different entity than where it is today and where it's going to be tomorrow. And the Citizen Advisory Board no longer has a role as far as most of us concerned. I don't even think it exists. I'm not sure 5 years ago when that decision was made, how many people were really on the Citizen Advisory Board to make that decision. So I think it's time to maybe, for the benefit of the city, because I think it's a wonderful asset for the city and for all of us who live up there, to figure out is there a way we could sit down in these paths and so forth. These are really delicate, interesting decisions, and we'd like to not have them forced into a kind of a vote of a council, but really let's reconsider, because we've got time to do that, I think. When I look at that graphic up there and the Pequoy property to the left, it totally cuts off that pathway, and if the existing plan is proposed, then it's only the Pequoy people that we have to talk to next about, you know, giving up that space, and they don't have that much land there. So I think Mass Development has to be at the table to say they have to make these decisions, and then where are we as residents and interested parties in the community, where is our voice to be heard? So I'd like some consideration from your body here to understand how we can get our voices into the process to help make it a better community down the road. Thank you.
Yes,
just one observation about traffic and vehicles. I notice on the public road there don't seem to be any parking places. When you have shared driveways, which many of us do in the other part, it's difficult to have visitors park in your driveway because your neighbor's wanting to go in and out. With 83 units, there will be many visitors. Where will those visitors' cars be? And I think there should be some provision for that.
More comments before we take it back to the board?
Would it be appropriate to have the applicant respond to some of these questions or concerns?
I'd like to get us, we can certainly draw them in when we do.
So it's not going to be closed?
No, I'm not going to close. No. I did get a hand in the back. We'll take you.
Yes, hi. Hi, I'm Susan Brightus.
The thing that you keep mentioning is that eventually it's all going to be our property. It's not going to be Mass Developments anymore. So you're leaving us with something that we have had no involvement with, and that, you know, there might be some concerns about some water issues or the parking issues. I know on the Pequoy side we have parking issues. It's really hard getting out of our driveways. So there's lots of issues that we're going to be left with. We are going to be left with everything. So please consider that. And I think as a voice, we're really important because, you know, as soon as that last building sold, we have to live with it and no one else does. So
thank you. All right. We'll leave
public hearing open so that we can go back and forth, but I'd like to get each of us a chance to sort of cover some of our questions, and we will ask questions of Jeff and bring him back in. Mark, great start.
Well, there's a lot of comments from the local residents that I think we need to take in, and there's a host of issues from the DPW that we even talked about, and the waiver request and so forth. So procedurally, Karen, what would you suggest for, start with the DPW, just with those issues?
Yeah, I mean, well, maybe you want to start the other way and start with sort of maybe thinking about some of the neighborhood concerns, and then go to DPW. But I mean, actually, it doesn't matter what order, but it might help because the DPW stuff is very technical about the subdivision. So, and I can certainly read the memo, or if you have questions, I don't know if any of you had a chance to even look at it because I sent it late.
I don't mean so much like right now, go through point by point as much as. You know, I don't feel comfortable with the amount of information that we have yet to even get into in the decision.
Yeah.
I think we just need to go through these point by point and so forth. So we're going to need time to do that. So I'm just trying to think procedurally what's the best route. Maybe hear some issues from the board, go back to the applicant, and then come back and start fresh with the DPW.
Yeah, and then you can, and then in the meantime, I could probably pull together some of the comments that maybe make sense for possible conditions, and then
I'd like
pull to have, DPW's.
Right, because the applicant should have an opportunity to respond to the DPW comments, so that maybe when we have that discussion, instead of talking about 25 issues, we're only talking about 6 because they've you know, addressed everything.
Right.
I don't have any expectation of closing this tonight.
Right.
And we received a very long review from the DPW about things that we are still digesting. We've heard from you. We think the applicant needs to hear from you, and we need to have this conversation. So I do think there's a good piece to kind of close on, and that is for the public and for us to remember what it means to do site plan. That this is, it's we have a set of rules. We may not have as much flexibility as you think we have. We're following a set of rules. If a developer actually follows those, then we accept the plan. And so there's some sort of realization here of what things we have the ability to change and request or condition and what we don't.
Right. So maybe so the path and the open space maybe is a good place to sort of provide that as a scenario. So, you know, you all look to see if what's been presented meets the requirement of connectivity. You don't redesign the plan or relocate it because your what's been presented works with the way the applicant has designed the layout, and if it meets the standards, then there wouldn't necessarily be a reason to modify that design or have the applicant modify the design. In terms of the property boundaries, you all don't have the jurisdiction to dictate what boundary area Mass Development's going to sell to another property owner. But if there's an area that looks like it's going to be open space, you could certainly say that area has to be permanently protected with no trees because your plan shows that there's not going to be anything that happens there. So in that way, it becomes protected, but the boundaries stay the same. You don't have any jurisdiction over that. In terms of, you know, design guidelines, the planning board adopted design standards as part of the 2003 special permit. From what I understand, and I think Jonathan Wright alluded to that, there was this other voluminous design book that Mass Development put together that has nothing to do with your review. That's on the private side. You only evaluate what the general design guidelines were that were approved in 2003. There is a requirement that you have a minimum of 6x8 front porch on or covered entry on every structure. So unless the board opts to waive that for some reason, you know, that's essentially the standard. There's not an architectural style that's required. Someone could come in and do modern buildings here, and the board could approve it. Mass Development might not want to approve that prospective buyer, but the board could approve that. So, and then in terms of...
I mean, the board, you're really saying the board's basically obligated as long as it's, you know, within the framework of the rules.
Right.
Right.
And there are a number...
We kind of have to approve it, otherwise it can be challenged in court and would probably lose.
Right. But there are a number of waivers that are requested that you're not obligated to approve because they're waivers from the standards, yeah. So I think there was a question about site plan, what was not provided. The confusing thing about this is there are three submittals. On the subdivision plan, there's no planting shown for the individual lots. That's on the separate site plan application, and that was in the submittal.
I was surprised to see on lighting that there were no lot line values, that there were just light locations shown on the plan. So maybe I missed something there. Am I wrong?
There was a photometrics plan that was submitted that included all the street lights.
Yes.
The only lighting in the co-housing portion are small bollard lights, the other low voltage landscape lights.
So you're making the case that there's no issue with perimeter lighting at all, and you don't need to do the lot line, zero lot line illumination?
I don't think there would be any issues. There's no lighting on any of the site-specific lots other than the pathway lighting I just mentioned, the co-housing. Okay. There's post lights.
Any other sort of questions?
Seven.
That you're, yes.
Sorry to hog everything, but would it make sense to, in instances like this in the past, where we've had to continue a hearing, we've just gotten everything out in the open so the applicant can take everything back, digest it, and come back to us and hopefully address most of the issues we're talking about. So the DPW issues, those are separate. We've got the memorandums. They can just slog through that
right.
list. I think collectively from the board, if we come up with a list that we agree with, that we've heard from today from the residents or internally from the board, supplement the DPW questions with our own, goes back to the applicant, and then come back, and then hopefully some of those issues are addressed.
And
if we looked at the waivers, and it was clear there were some we were not interested in, then they may as well know those so they can do something about it.
Are you proposing that we just do a quick round robin of our list of notes?
Essentially, yeah.
Agree.
And then maybe you want to have a discussion of the waivers after
right.
that.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to quickly run through these. So I noticed in the DPW there was the tree calipers less than 3 inches, and I understand that you want small trees that do what you need for them to for solar gain. But some of those trees were maples. They aren't staying low. So I just had a question about whether several of your selected plantings might eventually surprise you at their size.
No, so there are a number of trees that I indicated on the plan.
And you know, Jeff, maybe better that you don't even answer me. I think Mark's idea is that you just note what we're thinking, and if the answer is, you know, we'll get the answer maybe on the next round.
Sure.
I was concerned about the traffic study. I do think that it's a density factor, and I'm haven't let go of it yet. There was a note in the DPW, I mentioned it earlier, about a section of the sewer not being deep enough, but you'll certainly respond to them. I'm curious if the grass swales have a substrate that stabilizes them. So I don't know enough about wet bottom swales, but I know if they hold water, they're going to degrade. And so I wondered what structure goes on underneath there, and you can just deal with that later. I'm interested in maybe still talking about street width of 20 feet, although I accepted Carolyn's explanation. At first, I was really quite bothered by the north-south trail going through the co-housing drive. But I do think we need to think about the trails as being two different things.
I bike, and there's a whole different thinking when you're biking down a protected trail than if you're walking in the woods. And so we might need to sort of break those two apart to get through that story. I like the boardwalk to protect the beech trees. I do think we can talk about landscaping within lots. I think that's certainly something that I would expect us to discuss.
And just for a point of clarification, not to interrupt you, but on the site plans themselves, there is a lot more landscaping shown.
Yep.
I just want to be clear about that, that it doesn't show up in the subdivision plans, but it's two separate permits.
That was short list.
John. Mine will be shorter. I guess I got just a couple things. One is, to understand, explain again why your trail is where your trail is. And you don't need to do that now.
Not now.
But just that, the concept of what you guys were seeing and what you were trying to accomplish, you know, in that trail system.
Well, and sir, maybe to add on to that, now that you've seen some suggestions, give us an answer as to why that doesn't work the way you think it would. That might be helpful.
Right. I do think the traffic, just understanding what the expected traffic will be, not necessarily that it's going to cause a change, but understanding it. And I guess for me, because, you know, this has been a project that's gone on for a long time and various people on the board have been involved at various points, I'm one of the more recent people. I guess an understanding of how what you've presented tonight fits, doesn't fit, differs from, stays with where we started 15 years ago. And understanding that, you know, not that it, that whatever the original site plan was supposed to be exactly the same, but, you know, it was a budget, you know, and well, how has the budget, quote unquote, changed over time? I mean, I know that there was the pretty significant change in the number of units, but, you know, kind of a little bit of an evolutionary, like, that's where we started, here's where we are, here's why it has been an evolution, not a revolution, you know, things like that.
And that might be better answered by Mass Development.
Yeah, it could be.
Well, I just have kind of an observation slash question. Most of the comments by the neighbors tonight were about the number of units, the density, and the traffic, which is, of course, a direct function of the number of units. But as I understand it, and correct me if I'm wrong, Carolyn, there's this March 2010 MEPA filing, which establishes the number of units. That's a done deal, right? So I can understand some of the people who bought in there might be a little disappointed, but that's it, right?
Yeah, and there's a whole traffic mitigation plan based on that number of units, and there are a series of things that Mass Development actually has done and kept up with over the years to address traffic impacts on the city as a whole. So they're in compliance as far as that mitigation requirement is
concerned. I agree, in a big sense, I get the argument where people have moved in and they're saying they have no say in what's happening, and they're right, because essentially it's already been established 5 years ago, and their say is tonight in this back and forth that we have, but big picture was already established. So.
The trail issue, I don't quite understand. I mean, this connectivity thing, and it seems like it's connected perhaps through a parking lot or down a street. And is that really trail connectivity? It doesn't seem to me that would be the intention of how trails are supposed to work. But so I'd like to investigate that first.
Tess.
I don't have a lot.
You look at me like I have a lot. No, the trail issue I'm less concerned about. I think just reframing what we mean by trail is important. And I think that, you know, we talked a couple hours ago about complete streets. You know, we're talking about, instead of thinking of it as a street that's going to be dominated by cars, we have this paved portion that's accessible by a variety of vehicles. You know, I think it probably was very challenging to cite it. It maybe could be adjusted, but that'll come up. The thing that I was expecting, or that I guess I would like to just kind of toss out there, is my understanding from many years ago about this project is that it would be, you know, more the density in the village, but that it wouldn't be as you know, private vehicle dominated as it is. So to see some consideration for either car sharing or more encouraged bicycle and pedestrian access, I, you know, was under the impression this is pretty close to downtown, you know, so there should be a way to ensure that there's enough infrastructure and facilities for these alternatives. The bus shelter issue came up in the DPW waivers. I would strongly, you know, say that I wouldn't be inclined to want to waive that requirement. I think anything that we can do to provide infrastructure for something other than private vehicles is going to be important here. That's it. Everybody else has said everything already.
Mark, last call?
Most everything has been touched on other than the architectural guidelines. You know, I big picture, I like the layout. I like the thought process. I like the effort that went into it. I don't have a handle on why the architectural guidelines don't seem to have been followed to the degree that they should have been. And I'm not convinced that they couldn't have been. So I'd like to see some more effort or response on that.
And I've got one last one in closing. We've heard a couple of things tonight about once it's developed, it will be yours to maintain. And so I think there are ways to put some I don't have the right words, but covenants or requirements in condo association material, or to make people aware that when they are thinking about coming into this new house, that it comes with some responsibilities to take care of that swale, so that, you know, and I'm not sure that that's one example. I think there are more, but I just think we ought to think about this sort of what are we passing on concept.
Well, all the owners have signed on to that when they buy in, because there's this overall North Campus and then there's a South Campus. So okay, that's already there. And then there's so going along each one.
Okay.
And part of the problem is that they're probably this thick.
I agree.
Probably hard to read.
To Mark's point about the architectural guidelines, Carolyn, I understood you to say that what's referred to as guidelines aren't really applicable here.
No, there's two. There are apparently two sets. There is a set of guidelines that are required that the board enforces, and that some of the units, I think they've addressed in a couple of the designs, some of the units do, but other units don't necessarily. But there's a separate design criteria that Mass Development has utilized in their negotiations with purchasers, which you have no jurisdiction over. So some people may be under the impression that you have to pick from four different house styles. That's not what the design guidelines are that the Planning Board enforces. But there are guidelines, and I sent excerpts from them. We have them on our webpage. I'd be glad to just redistribute them, or at least the residential section anyway, because right, it covers streets and commercial districts and the whole north and south.
So have they complied with the guidelines that we have the authority to enforce?
No, not entirely. They're asking for waivers.
So I urge us all to go digest the DPW, although, you know, many of those are topics that I rely on the experts and
right,
engineers at
right,
the DPW to negotiate on our behalf.
Is this the thing that came? Mine didn't have any. What was all the attachments? All I got was this thing that said it was page one and then it was page one.
There are two memorandums. One was a one page, the other was nine pages.
Right, and the second page actually had two bullets that were really, they weren't substantive enough. But I think that more the issue is, I think it's more to digest sort of what kind of conditions can be culled, as opposed to trying to, you know, provide other, and really, I mean, that's the work that I would do. I did not have time to go through the entire packet before the meeting. So, you know, I will definitely do that for the next
And the waivers, we were going to look at the waivers.
Right.
Like the porch waiver.
Right.
Right.
Well, it sounds like there was some of that on this side of the table, too, so mm-hmm. maybe.
Yeah, you've got some of those things already.
Yeah. Okay.
Is that in their June 9th application or a subsequent one? Because I don't see a waiver request for design.
It was not officially requested, but given that...
they asked for no.
So I don't know. They can answer more clearly. I think they submitted additional graphics showing elevations, but I don't think there were, and the only request was that they want to look at some of those designs going forward so that, you know, potentially there'd be a condition that says before you build phase two or whatever that the board has to review, approve, you know.
So don't they have to request a waiver specifically in writing?
Yes, they should. But sometimes they don't, and I don't. And it's important to make sure those don't go by the wayside as mm-hmm. sort of an assumed approval
right.
without mm-hmm. having some discussion about it.
So if this was continued, do we have when it would be continued to?
Well, your next meeting is November 12th, I think. Where, October 12th?
Yeah.
Let me just check. We have... Two permits, permit applications for the 12th that I haven't been advertised yet, but that'll go in next week. Oh, one of them is the preliminary subdivision for that next section. But again, it's preliminary, so it's, you know, you're not... it's not going to be the detail that you're looking at here.
Right.
So you could continue it to later in the evening to take care of those other two things up front. And then there's only one meeting in November and one in December because of the holidays. So that means the next one wouldn't be till December 10th, I think.
Is that meeting in November enough time?
I think so, yeah. I mean, most of these, you know, I could respond to tonight, but...
November 12th or December 10th, yeah. So, you know, if you wanted to do it till the 12th, I would suggest maybe 8 p.m.
Yeah.
And that may not be necessarily quite enough time to get through the other things, but at least,
right.
you know, it's not right up front.
At least you won't have me trying to violate open meeting law.
So can I get a proposal to continue the hearing?
Motion to continue to November 10th. So.
12th,
sorry.
Second.
At 8 p.m.
At 8 p.m., right.
Thank you all for all your time. Our next proposal will probably be to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Second by Ann.